question, so I think we'll be fine just managing the time. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is a public hearing for the City of Norfolk Planning Commission. At this time, we ask you to turn off pagers, cell phones, or other electronic signaling devices. The procedures for this public hearing are located in the lobby, along with the agenda and copies of the staff recommendations for today's hearings. Meeting schedules and agenda for the City Planning Commission are available online. Staff reports and maps for the City Planning Commission hearings will be available online approximately 1 week prior to the public hearing. To access this information, log on to www.norfolk.gov/planning. If you wish to speak on an item on today's agenda, you must fill out a request form with a member of staff located in the council chamber lobby. We normally hear items in the order in which they are listed on the agenda. The planning department staff will introduce each item by stating the type and purpose of the application and the location of the property. A staff member will deliver a presentation on each item, following a recommendation on each application to be considered at this hearing. Following the staff presentation, the commission will hear from proponents and then from opponents, if there are any. Anyone who has signed in to speak will be called by the chair. He or she should approach the podium, state his or her name and mailing address. The speaker should speak directly to the commission and not the audience. Remarks will be limited to 3 minutes each. However, the applicant's time will not be limited. After all proponents and opponents have been heard, the commission will allow rebuttal first from proponents, then opponents. Total time for the rebuttals are limited to 5 minutes each. At the conclusion of the hearing on each item, and after considering all information presented, the commission will take action on the matter. Action on each matter by the commission will be to recommend approval or denial by majority vote. The statement of the motion in the affirmative by a member of staff is a matter of voting procedure and in no way indicates the recommendation of the staff or consensus of the commission. Following the action by the commission on the matter, a written recommendation will be made to City Council, except for those applications where the decision of the Planning Commission is final. Anyone who attends the commission public hearing for a specific item will be notified by the City Clerk's office on the date on which City Council will consider the application. However, it is the responsibility of each applicant to contact the City Clerk's office to confirm the hearing date and time of the City Council public hearing. Susan, please call the roll.
Mr. Fraley?
Here.
No, Ms. Austin is absent. Ms. Shelton?
Here.
Mr. Bateman?
Here.
Mr. McGee?
Here.
Ms. Sutter?
Here.
And Mr. Murphy?
I am here. And we will deal with the Architectural Review Board items first. Ms. Susan McBride?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We have two nice applications here. The first one is the HRT Ferry Shelter at the Waterside Dock. They got their inspiration from some of the industrial type things that we see around town. It is zoned in the downtown waterfront. These are renderings of the shelter. It will have glass enclosure on three sides, open on the fourth side, painted corrugated metal shelter, and it is very low maintenance, water resistant. There will actually be two of these to sort of match on the Portsmouth side at their two docks. This is a very nice rendering of what it will look like when it's done. So you have views from both sides of whether you're at the shelter or on the walkway, the boardwalk. The ARB is unanimously recommends support of the design and materials be approved to the City Planning Commission.
Thank you. Any questions, commissioners? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to approve the project as presented. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. Next item.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a new construction shops along Collie Avenue. They're the Park Place shops. It is zoned community commercial. The applicant, this is a very nice shot of the building if you're going north on Collie. The applicant would like to add awnings to over the windows and doors. These awnings are going to encroach. This is a sample of the color and the material. So this is the other end of the building. This is a rendering drawing of the canopy. These are side views. One is what it would look like over the doors versus over the windows. It's a shed style, open on either end with decorative poles connecting the awning to the building. So here's a rendering of what it would look like if you're standing at the corner looking down. They'll all be the same style. So the ARB also recommends a unanimous vote for approval of the encroaching awnings style and material.
Thank you. Commissioners, any questions for Susan? Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the project as presented. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. Public hearing items?
Okay, so before taking up today's agenda, we've got a couple of items. The first one is going to be a withdrawal, and that is the application by the City Planning Commission for the zoning ordinance for... Anyway, it's to amend the PDMUE speech district. So that's going to be withdrawn. Don't have to consider that one. We also have another one I'm going to put a motion for the continuance, and that's item number 2 on your regular agenda, and that is the City Planning Commission for a text amendment to amend the Norfolk zoning ordinance to allow a vendor park in the IL District Industrial Light and the IG Industrial General District, and to create performance standards. So the motion is to continue the item until your meeting on November 17th. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is an application by the City Planning Commission.
Item 2.
For zoning text amendment for the Norfolk zoning ordinance to revise and remove inconsistent definitions and fix clerical errors.
Excuse me one second. We're going to continue item 2. Do we need
Correct.
To do that up front or do that in the order on the agenda?
We just did it.
We didn't bolt? Okay. Great. Thank you. I'm paying attention. All right, Austin.
Good afternoon, commissioners. As Susan said, we are back again with another cleanup text amendment. So, again, this just makes minor technical changes and corrections across Articles 2, 4, and 5 of the zoning ordinance. No significant policy changes. It's more just maintenance of zoning ordinance. And that should say 9 instead of 10. I apologize for that mistake as well. First, we'd like to correct an error in the variance review standards. We've worked with Adam, the deputy city attorney, to make the criteria for obtaining a zoning ordinance clearer. And changing Article 2 to it just changed the wording of the clause to make it clear. Secondly, we would like to add a provision to the hotel performance standards to require a hotel or motel manager to be available on site 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We noticed that as we were doing the in performance standards, this currently didn't exist in the hotel performance standards, so we would just like to add that in there as well. Next, we would like to amend the short-term rentals sections to remove a reference to the 24-hour call center because we've been informed that it is not a 24-hour call center and we've been asked to change that. Next, we would like to correct the citations found in the optional registration for vacation rentals and homestays since these citations have changed since this section was originally written, so just correcting some of the citations found within. Next, we would like to clarify the applicability statement of the screening section. It's not completely clear and consistent with some of our other development sections, so we'd like to change that a little bit to make it clearer. Next, we would like to clarify that open space set-asides do apply to multifamily dwellings with 3 to 9 dwelling units. There's currently a little bit of, not a loophole, but it's not clear. The language currently doesn't speak to multifamily dwellings with 3 to 9 units, so we would just like to change this to speak to dwellings with 3 to 9 units. We would like to clarify the dormer size restriction for accessory structures. That's currently a rule that already exists. We're just changing some of the language to make it clearer. Next, we would like to add flexibility to the standards for fences and walls and allow the zoning administrator to allow exceptions to the rules for very site-specific circumstances. Next, we would like to clarify the alternative minimum resilience quotient requirements for non-residential development as well, just to make that clear, because we've had a couple issues in major site plan reviews. And I believe that is the last item. Yes.
Thank you, Austin. Any questions for Austin? Susan, please call the vote.
So the motion is to recommend approval of the zoning text amendment to revise and remove inconsistent definitions and fix clerical errors. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
Okay. Item number three on your regular agenda is a request by Old Dominion University Foundation for change of zoning from CC, which is community commercial, and IL, light industrial, to conditional UV, University Village, at 1056, 1064, 1070, 1080, West 39th Street, NSW 39th Street, GPIN 14286726691428672647, 14287 and 14287 0645, 1035 through 1089 West 40th Street, 1041 through 1083 West 41st Street, and 3912 4024 Hampton Boulevard. The purpose of this request is to rezone properties owned by the ODU Real Estate Foundation. Okay. This is a request by Old Dominion University, and it is for a rezoning. The site is located on the east side of Hampton Boulevard between 39th and 49th Streets. You may recognize this site. About a year ago, we rezoned this site, and we rezoned it into the CC Zoning District. However, since that time, the building has gotten a little bit taller, and the site has grown by just a little bit. And similar to today, the rezoning was for a mixed-use building. So again, today it's proposed to be rezoned from CCNIL to University Village. Now, as of Tuesday, last month we did a text amendment, and we changed University Village to Monarch Way. So really it's to Monarch Way, just to clarify that. This is the floor plan for the project. And again, not too much has changed since we looked at it through the last rezoning. The grocery store space has shrunk just by hair. I think it was 50,000. It is now 48,054 square feet. The commercial space that is along Hampton 41st and Monarch Way actually got a little bit larger at 30,199 square feet. Number of residential units are the same, 352. I think the parking increased just a hair. It's 843 spaces. And that includes there are 52 spaces on the streets. And then as part of the development of the text amendment that we did last month, this project will be required to get a development certificate. Not doing that today. It will come back to you for the design through a development certificate, again, first ARB and then through the Planning Commission. We are recommending approval of this project. Again, it is in compliance with Plan Norfolk 2030 as well as the Central Hampton Boulevard area plan, and there are proffered conditions. It has to be built in accordance to the site plan that was submitted. They will have to obtain a development certificate. It's limited to 352 dwelling units. There will be elevators in each unit, and then they also proffered inclusionary housing, and it would be 10% of the units would be for people making 80% of the median income. So with those proffered conditions, staff is recommending that this application be approved.
Great, thank you. Commissioners, any questions for Susan?
Inclusionary housing is
10%.
10%, thank you.
Anything else? All right, please stand by. We have three people signed up as applicant representatives. Please let me know if you'd like to speak. Tara Saunders. Thank you. Burrell Saunders. Thank you. Mark Richardson.
Same question.
And finally, Jason Vickers Smith. Jason?
Just here to answer questions.
Super. Commissioners, any questions for the people here to answer questions? I think we're all pretty familiar with this project. Let's call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the rezoning, subject to the proper conditions. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thanks. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Next item.
Okay. The next item is Perry Glass Studio for the following applications. A rezoning from HCG1, Ghent Historic and Cultural Conservation, to DAD, Downtown Arts and Design at 253 Gray Street, and B, for a development certificate for 253 Gray Street and 745 Duke Street. The purpose of the request is to allow for the expansion of the existing art studio. Okay, as I mentioned, this is a request by the Perry Glass Studio. The existing studio is located on the southwest corner of Gray Street and Duke Street. It is in keeping with the future land use plan, which designates this area as downtown. So again, as I mentioned, it is for a rezoning to rezone just a small portion from HCG1 to DAD, which is the Downtown Art District, as well as for a development certificate. And if you can see on the graphic, there's an area, a parcel that's highlighted in black, and then the little white triangle there, that's actually the portion that we're rezoning. The remainder of the site, and the site is actually contains two parcels, the remainder is already in the DAD district. So it's really a rezoning of just that triangular portion. So this is the site plan here. On the upper right-hand side, you can see the existing building right at the corner of Grace and Duke. Below that, on Duke Street, is the proposed addition. And then we're getting some nice amenities, a rain garden, and then there's a footbridge that leads over to the parking. And again, that red line depicts the other side of that as the area that needs to be rezoned. On this site, this is the floor plan of both the existing glass studio as well as the addition. The yellow portion is what the addition is. And in that addition, you'll have a theater, mold, metal, and wood shop, classrooms, and offices. And as part of the development certificate, again, as I mentioned, it goes first through ARB and then to you all. I'm going to hand it over now for Susan to explain the ARB recommendation on this application.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is a beautiful project. It's going to be two stories, as Susan mentioned, an addition of 22,000 square feet to an existing 8,700 square foot building. The addition will add glass making studios, classrooms, and a 90 seat theater. The design principles for which they used, they wanted the building, the addition, to have functional beauty, outdoor space using the building as landscape. If you know, you can see how the design builds around three mature trees. Oops, I guess I can't do that. But the two on Grace Street and one in between the two additions. One of the principles that they would like to do is put the glassmaking process on display, which I think you'll see how they do that as I go on. Create an excellent visitor experience. They want it to be flexible, adaptable, and allow for future museum growth. And site responsive in their resilient design for the landscaping, which is not part of this. The landscaping will come back. So that leads them into the program goals. They want to connect the museum's glass collection with an educational focus. They're going from one classroom up to seven. They want to maintain the intimacy between the artists and the audience, foster and incubate artists. Excuse me. They want to serve a broad range of visitors, accessibility. If you, I can't, move it on here, but they do a really nice job creating access to the building that's subtle in design. It goes, appears to be part of the landscape, and so they have a ramp and stairs, so it allows people to get in easily. The design glass making spaces for function and safety, provide visual access to glass studios for osmosis learning or you know, visual learning. They want to design their HVAC system to assure comfortable environment, present welcoming face to the Neon District, visibility from Brambleton, as you can see in the far right-hand corner, Brambleton. And they're also elevating the site 4 feet to mitigate for flooding. In this photo, in this image, in front of the existing building where the addition starts is their entrance promenade, which is intentionally designed to align with the Chrysler Museum. The second floor terrace overlooks, which is above the entrance promenade, has views of the Chrysler Hag in Ghent. Duke Street, oh, this is in Duke, hold on, here we go. The Duke Street side has large windows visible from the sidewalk so people passing by may look into the educational spaces, which they call shops, where students learn the process and techniques of glass blowing. Mature tree, let's see, in this image, you can see that's one of the trees that they'll be keeping. It softens the transition between the existing building and the new addition. On Grace Street, you're probably familiar, you don't get a really good view of this, but at their old entrance to the right, they have an outdoor space for a hot shop that allows sharing the process with attendees or people on the street. This, the materials for this building are a terracotta panel with white, which echoes that strong line from the old building, the band, to the new building for continuity. It has black metal panel. I believe it mitigates the visual size of the addition as not to stunt the growth of the existing building. They have black perforated metal screening for the mechanical. It allows air circulation while hiding the mechanical. They also have some coal-colored bricks with that'll be oversized in width and matching mortar for a more contemporary look. If you haven't already, I encourage you to look through the application in your Dropbox with the simulated interior images, which are beautiful. The ARB was very complimentary of this design and appreciated the compatibility of the design with the existing building and landscape. They unanimously recommend the design for approval. And I know Mel Price is here with WPA if you have questions.
Okay, thank you, Susan. Commissioners, any questions for Susan or Susan? As mentioned, Mel Price is signed up to speak as the applicant representative only if there is opposition.
Do you want me to finish the?
Sure, I didn't realize we were.
So just finishing up on the development certificate part of it. So, when you get a development certificate, you have to obviously comply with all the requirements of the DAD district, and there are certain things that you can request waivers for. So those are building placement requirements, off-street parking and loading requirements, and requirements for use of ground floor. That's only on Duke Street, which is a principal street in this district. For building placement, the DAD district requires that 75% of each facade front on the property line. Approximately half of the facade along Gray Street, which is where the front is brought up to the property line. And then on the side street on Duke Street, that mimics the setback. So it does not comply with the building placement. So for both of those streets, the applicant would be required to get a waiver for the building placement. As far as the parking, no waivers required. There's no parking that's required in that district. They do provide 59 spaces, however, but no waivers required. And for required use of ground floor, again, there's a list of things that are required to be on the ground floor. This building does comply with that, so a waiver is not required for that. So the only waiver that's required is for the placement of the building. Staff is recommending that the application be approved, subject to the necessary waiver for the setbacks. Any questions?
Thank you. Any questions? As I was saying, Mel Price has signed up as the applicant representative. If there's opposition, there's no opposition. Nothing you have to add? Great. Nice job. Thorough presentation. Any comments or questions? Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the rezoning as well as the development certificate subject to the necessary waiver. Mr. Fraley?
Of Norfolk being the cultural hub of Hampton Roads, I think this is a valued and exciting addition to keep enhancing that character of our great city. I vote yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thank you.
Okay. The next item number 5, East Beach Marketplace, Phase 1. For a conditional use permit to allow more than 24 dwelling units at 4231 East Little Creek Road. The purpose of this request is to allow the development of 92 multifamily dwelling units. Okay, so again, the applicant is East Beach Marketplace. And this site is actually in, or it is the East Beach Marketplace Shopping Center. There we go. Highlighted in red there. It is on the southeast corner of East Little Creek Road and Shore Drive. The Plan Norfolk designates it as commercial. The project is in keeping with Plan Norfolk 2030. The site is actually zoned CR, which is regional commercial, and multifamily is permitted in that district, but if there are more than 24 units, it does require a conditional use permit, which is why the applicant is here today. This is an overview of the existing shopping center. To accommodate the multifamily residential, a portion of the existing shopping center would be demolished, and I've highlighted those or put a outline around those portions of the shopping center that would be removed. First, there's the perpendicular piece to East Little Creek Road on the left-hand side of the screen. Then a little bit further to the east or the right is the other portion of that shopping center that would be removed. This is the proposed layout of the multifamily. You can see there would be a couple of points of ingress from East Little Creek Road. They're existing. And then there would also be outdoor space for the residential located kind of at the bottom of the, it's an L shape at the bottom there. And then, you know, the next application is a for another application within the same shopping center. So they're really looking to redo the shopping center and reinvigorate the shopping center, and that is a part of it. So the shopping center, as currently developed, is underutilized. I said that. The redevelopment site will diversify the site by adding multifamily, decrease the amount of commercial space, and replace it with a smaller commercial building, and would render the site more viable for the future. And staff is definitely supporting that. However, staff cannot support the request. As we learned in our last application and every application we've done for multifamily so far, we have required that they work with our community of housing and development to get a recommendation on what kind of inclusionary housing would be required or requested as part of a rezoning or a conditional use permit. In this case, 10%, again, similar to the last one, was requested. The applicant isn't willing to do that. And based on that, not because we are concerned about the project, we think the project is a great project, but not willing to do that. So based on that, we are not supporting the application. Any questions I can answer?
All right, thank you. Please stand by. We have the applicant representative signed up to speak, Nick Jacobides. Name and mailing address, please.
Good afternoon. Nick Jacobides, 1439 North Great Neck Road, Suite 201, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23454. Thank you for your time today, Commission. I'd like just to mention a few things here. Obviously, I'm available for questions. I am the developer and contractor that's going to be building the apartment complex, and I'm here to represent the owner, East Beach Marketplace, on this. The current owner owns the entire center, has 50,000 square feet of vacant space, is experiencing lack of, you know, rental interest, a lot of vacancy, vandalism, and came to us several years ago wanting to reinvigorate the center. And we've been working together to work on a plan to reinvigorate it. The goal here is to bring these 92 units, residential units, to the table, and also allocate it properly to the street, because right now there's a strip center that's really perpendicular. It faces the wrong way. A lot of it's vacant, for those of you that are familiar. But the goal of all of this is to bring higher quality commercial tenants to the area. By boosting the demographics around for the rents to make sense for commercial tenants to want to go in there based on their search of the incomes around. We did discuss the inclusionary housing aspect with Planning Department and Department of Housing, and we appreciate the need for inclusionary housing. This project specifically will not work with the lack of the income that would come from the disparity from the market rent side with the inclusionary units. The financial impact is such that the financing would not work. This is it's a market rate project. It's not a LIHTC tax credit or a VHDA project. It's a full market rate project that's been presented. And that's what was also presented to the Civic Leagues as well. A big part of our support that came from both Civic Leagues was that they did want to see high rents and all of this. They really pushed us to really, you know, keep the rents high so that it would encourage more commercial tenancy to come in with some higher quality tenants to the area. I believe that's all I needed to cover, but I'm available if you have any questions.
Great, thank you very much for coming down. Commissioners, any questions for Mr. Jacobides?
I do have a question. You said this a couple of times, higher quality tenants. What do you mean by that?
So in the existing center right now, there are a mix of commercial type tenants that are everywhere around the whole, you know, Brown Town, but they want to bring, like, you know, there's a food line in the center now that does very, very well. And the community around there would love to see a higher quality grocer. They'd like to see a potential down the road, a Harris Teeter, a higher quality grocer. They'd also like, you know, to move away from there's some cell phone stores, vape shops, things like that. And they'd like to see some higher quality food and beverage usage as well out there, because it's a little bit of a food desert.
You said it's a food desert? But there's a food line there.
The food desert in terms of dining. There's not a whole lot of dining options. And the tropical smoothie that's there now, that's in this center, has a drive-through, but it's on the, it doesn't have a drive-through, but it's on the end of the center that doesn't really, you can't see it from Little Creek Road. So most of that side of that center that's being torn down is coming out. And obviously, you'll see probably on the next slide from Susan about the outparcel retail building with a drive-through that's being presented as well, that I'm here to represent as well.
And just to be clear, you think Food Line is a lower quality type tenant? Attract lower quality tenants?
Well, no, it's actually the grocery store is doing very, very well there, but the community has told us, the Civic Leagues have told us, that they'd prefer, you know, some other higher quality options for food for grocery stores.
So I just wanted to make sure that I'm understanding. They want to establish more of an exclusionary?
I think for purposes of the rest of the center, you'll see you can get probably in that same center across the street, down the street. There's a lot of the similar tenants, if you will, and they're looking for a different mix of tenants, if you will.
I see.
You mentioned that the project won't work if you add the affordable housing component. What does that mean? Are you saying if you were to add one unit, the project wouldn't work? If you were to add five units, the project wouldn't work?
Well, the request was for the 10%, and after factoring in the disparity in rents from what the market rate rents are to the 80% number, it's a close to 100, about a, you know, a six-figure income loss to the project on a yearly basis, and that keeps the project from being financeable.
So at the 10% level, it won't work?
Yes.
Okay, gotcha. I have one other follow-up question, if I may. So I've got a letter here from Ms. Venable. I assume she works with you. It says that your goal here is to create a walkable mixed-use community that ties into its surroundings and becomes a pedestrian-friendly mixed-use neighborhood with unique charm and character. Later in this letter, it also says you'll create a mix of uses that are not vehicle-dependent. As I look down at the conceptual site plan, I see a whole lot of parking spots. I also see a request for a drive-through. So help me see this as a walkable mixed-use community. I recognize that it is an existing parking lot, and what you're doing is an improvement. But if I were to think about traversing from the drive-through out parcel to the apartment building, the only way I can see to do that would be to navigate the parking lot. So help me understand this. That element.
So the new multifamily building and the drive-through, the new drive-through?
Help me better see walkable mixed-use community.
Yeah, so the idea is you've got, you know, commercial-type tenants. There's grocery stores, there's a Starbucks, there's a Papa John's, there's all kinds of others, a CVS. From the multifamily to the shopping that's all around the area, it's easily walkable from back and forth. So it's essentially just creating that, you know, being able to come home, park, and then be able to walk from home to the grocery store or to the coffee shop or back and forth.
Through the parking lot.
Yes, but there's walkways that connect it as well through the site plan.
Gotcha, okay.
Thanks, Jeremy. Mr. Fraley.
Is an Aldi or a Lidl more high quality than a Food Lion?
You know, that's a personal opinion, and I don't know that I'm the one to answer that question, quite frankly. I'm just telling you what I'm, you know.
How about Whole Foods?
Again, I mean, it's not my, I don't know if that I can really, you know, my personal opinion is one thing.
Right. Okay, commissioners, any other questions or comments?
Just one off of Mr. McGee's comment there. So was there any attempt at negotiating that 10% between you and the city?
Well, in talking to the request was for the 10%, and it kind of at that point, once the 10% didn't work, we didn't get into any other. It was kind of like 10% or nothing. There was no discussion of should we, you know, can we look at two units? Can we look at one unit? You know, whatever, that was never brought to the table. But no, that hasn't been you know, discussed.
Any other questions or comments for the applicant or staff? Great, thank you very much
thank
for coming
you.
Down.
Thank you.
Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Fraley?
No.
Ms. Shelton?
No.
Mr. Bateman?
Yeah, I worry about the precedent of projects not, you know, meeting the criteria that the city has set, especially if it comes down to a financial. It sounds like this project is very closely aligned on from a financial perspective, that inclusionary housing is not going to work. So even if it potentially would be negotiated differently, so I would have to vote no also.
Mr. McGee?
I support the concept of taking unused parking spots and turning it into walkable mixed-use communities. I don't think the site plan we have in front of us quite does that just yet. Also concerned about the affordable housing component, and with that, I vote no.
Ms. Sutter?
No.
And Mr. Murphy?
No. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Item 6.
Okay. Item number 6, keeping the same shopping center, East Beach Marketplace Phase 2 for a conditional use permit, drive-through facility, large scale at 4037 East Little Creek Road. The purpose of this request is to allow the restaurant to operate a commercial drive-thru. Okay, so again, this is within the same shopping center. This is a building that currently sits up front. It's, I don't know if you can see it, it's got the red star there. That is a, I think it's a bank building. They are proposing to demo that. Again, in keeping with the Plan Norfolk 2030, site is designated as commercial. Zone CR, any sort of drive-through would require a conditional use permit in that district. This is what's being proposed. So it's a five-bay smaller commercial shopping center. Again, they're losing, if the whole project were to come to fruition, they're losing some of the commercial. They're proposing to put newer commercial up front on this out parcel. The drive-through would go in the end unit. It's slightly highlighted in blue, with the drive-through coming around the back and towards the front of the building. And it's circled in the red on the right side of the slide to show you where it is, where it sits in the shopping center. These are the elevations. And staff is recommending that the application be approved. Again, this is bringing new life, new viability to the shopping center. And staff is recommending that the application be approved, subject to the conditions contained in the staff report, which are the site plan and the elevations. Any questions I can answer?
So the new building would be smaller than the existing building?
That's my understanding of what's being removed.
Right. So would the applicant be able to do this part of the project and not the previous part of the project?
You'd have to talk to him.
Okay. We'll do that. Okay. Any questions for Susan? Thank you. Here to speak on behalf of the applicant is Nick Jacobitis.
I'm here for questions.
Thank you. I've got one. Do you mind coming up? And I apologize, but you're going to have to state your name and mailing address again for the record.
Nick Jacobitis, 1439 North Great Neck Road, Suite 201, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23454.
So if the previous project, the residential portion, doesn't move forward, do you intend to move forward with this part of the project?
That hasn't been discussed yet because we didn't think it was a possibility as far as the owner didn't,
right.
But it would probably severely hamper it.
Okay. Because I'm concerned if the other part of the project happens, we actually increase the amount of parking, the amount of drive-through, and make it even less walkable. So just want to make sure I got my mind around it correctly.
If you're saying if the strip center does happen without the multifamily?
If the item that we're considering, which mm-hmm. is a drive-through, mm-hmm. If the multifamily does not happen, do you intend to pursue the drive-through, the new building?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Any other questions for the applicant? Comments? Call the vote, please.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Fraley?
Based on what I think I just understood, I vote aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
If I know, we'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thank you for coming downtown. Number seven, please.
Number seven, 930 Redgate Avenue for a renewal of a conditional use permit to operate short-term rental units, vacation rental, at 930 Redgate Avenue. The purpose of this request is to allow a four-unit multifamily apartment to renew the operation of a short-term rental unit.
All right. Yep. So this item is for a conditional use permit to continue the operation of a short-term rental vacation rental in a four-bedroom converted fourplex on the north side of Redgate Avenue between Hampton Boulevard and Greenway Court in the West Kent neighborhood. The applicant is currently lawfully operating under an existing conditional use permit since 2020 that is about to expire. His short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030 or the future land use map, which designates this site along with parts of the surrounding neighborhood as residential mixed. Residential mixed is described as having a greater variety of housing types than generally found in other residential categories. The property is conditionally zoned community commercial. In this district, all short-term rentals require a conditional use permit. So here we see the site of the short-term rental units. It was built in 1957 as offices. It was rezoned and converted for use as short-term rentals in 2020. It is compliant with parking requirements via a rear parking lot and is already in compliance with the required 10% tree canopy. So before I get into this section, I'll explain the changes that we've made in our analysis. Based on feedback from the Planning Commission, this section now calls out all short-term rentals, regardless of whether they're single-family or multifamily, in order to provide more inclusive numbers. These are the number of parcels with short-term rentals on them. So for vacation rentals nearby this site, there's currently one vacation short-term rental which is this site because it's currently operating under a conditional use permit. And there is one homestay short-term rental for a total of two registered short-term rental parcels within 1 mile. An additional short-term rental is pending. We're currently tracking three additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area. This property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. So within 500 feet, there's only the one registered short-term rental, which is this property, and an additional one non-registered short-term rental. So along the same lines as the previous analysis, this one has changed as well. Responding to commission feedback, we're looking at all parcels that are residential and the portion of those residential parcels that are used as short-term rentals. So for the neighborhood analysis for within 1 mile of this project, approximately 76% of the parcels are residential and less than 0.1% or two of those are short-term rentals. 76.6% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential and 1.7% of those are short-term rentals. And again, that short-term rental unit is this one that's currently operating. So staff is recommending approval subject to the standard conditions that we attach to the short-term rentals, including the emergency contact being posted inside and outside of the building, which is able to respond to emergencies within 20 minutes, 24 hours a day. The short-term rental will continue to maintain existing remote entries, exterior security cameras, and interior noise monitors. This property will have private trash removal, and the conditional use permit would expire in 2 years. Questions?
Thank you, Russell. Anytime. Any questions for Russell?
Russell, I can recall this from years back. This was one of our early short-term rentals, and I know we had a strong and long debate over it. Do you know of any calls for service that they've had during the course of their CUP?
I believe there was one call for service during the course of their CUP, which was related to a domestic incident that was called in by somebody not at the property that they suspected a relative had been involved in on the property. But it's my understanding, I got some more details on that one when I wrote this up, and there were no charges or anything filed and associated with that, so I'm not sure that anything actually came of it.
Thank you, Russ.
Yes, sir.
Anyone else? Thank you. The applicant is here. We have John and Luciano Rizzo. Would either of you like to speak? You don't mind stating your name and mailing address?
Of course. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Luciano Rizzo, 1322 West 38th Street, Norfolk, Virginia, 23508. I'd like to address the concern that Mr. Fraley has about the call that was mentioned. I received a call at about 1 o'clock in the morning. I am the person responsible for being available within 20 minutes. I received a phone call from the guest who had informed me that the police had arrived and that they were discussing some domestic dispute that had occurred. The gentleman that was reported to have caused the dispute had already left the property, and the guest who made the reservation, which happened to be another person, actually canceled the reservation, and so I kindly requested the guest to depart from the unit, and it was a minor disturbance, if that. Everything proceeded as usual the rest of the night, and I informed the other guests that there was nothing to worry about and that the disturbance should have ceased.
Thank you for sharing that.
Any further questions?
Have you gotten any other concerns or complaints from neighbors?
I'd like to note that we haven't gotten any complaints or concerns from the neighbors. But what we did have another incident that was not mentioned, the fire department did come out. One of our smoke detectors was faulty. It had a beeping noise, and the guest was concerned. Rather than contacting me, she contacted the fire department directly, and they came out for about 5 minutes, inspected, and told her that everything was fine, and then went along. And I appreciated the guest for doing that because we want to make sure that the professionals handle that job and not me directly.
Did the fireman replace the battery?
We have since replaced the. We not only replaced the battery, we replaced the entire smoke detector.
So. Thank you, sir. Any other questions for the applicant?
Appreciate your transparency on that.
Yeah.
Yes, of course.
Thanks for attending the public hearing.
Of course.
Please stand by. We have no one signed up to speak for or against the application. Commissioners, any comments or questions? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit, subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thanks. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Item 8.
Okay. Item Angie Lundy for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit, vacation rental, at 1106 Toller Place. The purpose of the request is to allow a single-family home to operate as a short-term rental unit.
All right. So this agenda item is for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental vacation rental in a five-bedroom single-family home on the north side of Toller Place, west of 11th View Street in the Willoughby neighborhood. A short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which describes Coastal Character District as an eclectic mix of housing types interspersed with neighborhood-scale commercial uses. Property is currently zoned residential coastal. All short-term rentals with more than three bedrooms are required to have a conditional use permit to operate. So here we see the site for the proposed short-term rental. It was built in 1981 on a 10,000 square foot lot. It is compliant with parking requirements and the applicant has consent to use the shared driveway. And due to site characteristics, it's unable to come more fully into compliance with the required 20% tree canopy. However, the applicant will be completing restoration of the dune, which will remove invasive vine growth, replant approved dune grass in all bare spots of the dune, and post signs to notify guests to stay off of the dune vegetation. Finally, the applicant will be elevating the home's HVAC mechanical system to more fully comply with existing flood regulations. So for other vacation rentals nearby, there's currently 25 vacation short-term rentals, three homestay short-term rentals, for a total of 28 registered short-term rental parcels in a one-mile radius. An additional 13 short-term rentals are pending. We're currently tracking 8 additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area. This property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. Within 500 feet, there's currently only one registered short-term rental parcel and an additional one pending short-term rental. For the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 93% of parcels are residential, 3.6% or 28 of those are short-term rentals, 98.4% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential, and 1 or 1.7% of those are short-term rentals. So staff is recommending approval of the proposal subject to the standard conditions, among those the emergency contact posted inside and outside the building that is able to respond within 20 minutes, 24 hours per day. The short-term rental will have remote entry, exterior security cameras, and interior noise monitors, as well as private trash removal. Dune improvements will be added as a condition. Those will be completed in to the satisfaction of the city. And then the property will also be brought into closer compliance with current flood-related regulations in terms of the HVAC elevation. The permit will expire in 2 years. Questions on that?
Thanks, Russell. Mm-hmm. Commissioners, any questions for Russell?
I didn't see the Civic League letter.
So that's one of the opposition letters.
Yeah,
I believe it was number 6 in your application packet there.
Yes.
Okay.
Anything else, anyone? Great. The applicant is here. Please stand by, Russell. Angie Lundy.
Good afternoon, commissioners. Thank you very much for having me. Just flew in from Seattle, so I'm very grateful to be here.
Great. Can we get your name and mailing address,
sorry.
Please?
It's Angie Lundy. My mailing address is 1106 Toller Place in Norfolk, Virginia, 23503.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, thank you, staff, for the approval. I wrote a little research paper for you all, but I don't think you need it. So I just wanted to assure my neighbors that there's not going to be any parties. I think that's what they're concerned about. And I understand their concern. Just I'm a real estate agent. I also have a community development company that's nationally recognized and very responsible person. I myself don't have parties. I want to market it as a luxury rental. I have nice artwork in there that I don't plan to have damaged. And we're going to be very careful and selective about who we vet to stay there. I own several properties across the country, and I never had any problems with managing them, never had any complaints. I want my neighbors to understand that I'm going to be on call, and they can call me anytime or if they have any concerns. I'm very responsive, and I take care of my properties. The next thing is that, let's see, I think there was one other, the parking. So they were concerned about the parking. It's a shared parking space with my next-door neighbor. But he, too, used to operate a short-term rental, and he's all for it. And he also sent in another letter to you all to show his support. That's why I came here, and thank you all for the time.
Great. Any questions for Ms. Lundy?
Ms. Lundy,
yes,
how do you propose to be selective amongst your guests?
Well, that's a good question, because we can't discriminate against anyone. But I think that we're, I'm not going to just take anyone that has like a bad review, or if they have, and it's not going to be just for Airbnb. I'm considering other things. I came here, I purchased that house for my father who was sick, and it was for him to go fishing there. And then I ended up just staying because I fell in love with the city. So there's nursings, that nurses that need short-term housing. There's military families, but to be selective, I think I would vet them if they're through Airbnb to see what their history is like. And I know that Airbnb now also has strict rules on parties, and they're not allowing, they've become more strict on it. So to not be discriminatory, I would just say like what their history is. Mm-hmm. Thank you, sir.
I have a question. You said you own rentals across the country?
Not necessarily rentals, but I do own properties.
Do you own any rentals?
I have one rental that's for an employee of mine, but he's a vet, so it's to for that. So I have several properties that are, they're just used for different purposes.
Mm-hmm. Do you have experience managing a short-term rental like an Airbnb?
I have done an Airbnb rental before, but it wasn't for a long time. Mm-hmm. I only since I've had this house has been vacant now for several months, and I've let people stay there without pay, and I don't think even the neighbors had even noticed, but I probably had 10 to 15 different families staying there.
Who's going to manage it?
Oh, my neighbor, he lives right in front. I believe he's at 1104. His name is Robert Duncan, and he's a commercial real estate agent and property manager, so he already manages several other properties within the neighborhood and in Norfolk, so he has
good
experience. He's not here today, unfortunately. He had to go to the doctors, and he was going to come, so he couldn't make it.
Okay.
But I'm happy to share his information. I have him as a registered agent, actually.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any other questions while we have Ms. Lundy up here? Please stand by for the rebuttal period. Thank you.
Thank you.
No one signed up to speak in favor of this application, but we do have some opponents. Robert Witch, do you wish to speak?
Yes.
Come on.
It's Robert Wick, actually.
Oh, sorry.
1114 Toller Place, Norfolk, Virginia, 23503.
Great.
Yeah, primarily, we just live a couple houses down. I think the city of Norfolk has done a phenomenal job changing the shape of Ocean View, starting with East Beach and working your way out to Willoughby. I think you look at how many VRBOs and vacation rentals there are in that area. There's plenty of those available. But I think as soon as you make the transition from owner-occupied dwellings to properties where people can just come in, we get people out there with fireworks, parties. There's people, doing all sorts of things all hours of the day and night. It's just the last thing we need. We'd like to keep it a residential area. It's to me, it just kind of flies in the face of all the hard work that the city has done to improve the whole Ocean View area. So that's my opposition to it.
Great. I appreciate you coming down.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. James McLean. Next up, we'll have Val Black.
James McLean, 1112 Toller Place, Norfolk, Virginia, 23503. Don't do this very often. I'm a little bit nervous, but bear with me here. First, I wanted to thank Russell. Has been great. Russell helped me a lot. He's been very professional, and I've been on the phone with him a lot, and he's doing a good job. Hopefully, this hearing is to hear from the people and the citizens of Norfolk who've made substantial investments in their homes and want to maintain residential continuity in our neighborhood. I hope you guys have read the letters in the packet. There have been, I think, right many letters in the packet. And there have been survey passed around, people have signed that, commenting about it. This has nothing to do with Angie, or this has to do with our neighborhood. I've lived there 40 years. There are deed restrictions in our property for single-family residential for Willoughby Dunes. I put a copy of the deed in the pass-out to you all so you can see that. And that is for all the houses on Toller Place that are in Willoughby Dunes subdevelopment. To obtain a CUP, you pay your money, you meet all the mechanical and the physical requirements, the legal requirements, and you get a recommendation. And I understand that, and I've been told that once you get that, you're done. You can get a permit. And I hope that you all will look at this and show the judgment. The reason that you're here is to show judgment and not just go by the A, B, and C of the requirements. So to address that side of the equation, I believe the commission should be looking out for the interest of our neighbors who are Norfolk residents and citizens who have invested hundreds of thousands of dollars to be in a stable residential setting with single-family deeded restrictions that have been in place for over 40 years. It stops being a neighborhood when you allow short-term rentals next door again, just because they meet a parking requirement and they meet a fire detection requirement and a management requirement. I think the Planning Commission should take into consideration more than just those items. I'll hit on a couple of things that concern me. The parking. Because of the way things work, even though this is five bedrooms, only three parking places are required. Well, anybody that thinks that it only has three cars at a five-bedroom beach rental, we've all been to beach rentals before. We've all been out. We know that there's going to be a whole lot more than three cars, but three is a requirement. It actually was 3.4, and it rounds down instead of up. So the next thing is, if you look at the diagram of the property, to get in there, it's a long, narrow driveway. So when these cars get back out, they have to actually back out of the driveway to get out.
Sorry, sir, the time's up. In order to be respectful of everyone's time, we need to adhere to the time limit.
Real quick?
No, I'm sorry. But I appreciate you coming downtown. Val Black?
Hello, Val Black, 1114 Toller Place.
Thank you.
I'm especially nervous as well because I really like Angie. So it's kind of hard to be in opposition with her. But when this house was built some 40 years ago, it was built as a residential property. It's on a residential street. Everything on there is residential. It's been a residential home for the last 40 years, depending on who's lived there. As I understand it, a CUP is to help a non-conforming property continue to be non-conforming, but with certain pieces that help it to conform more so with the existing properties and hopefully to the betterment of that property and the other properties around it. What we're seeing, though, is that more and more conditional use permits are being allowed for Airbnb, VRB, short-term rentals. And what we get on the beach side of that is we're seeing more and more loud music all during the day, morning to into the evenings. People using the dunes as their personal private bathroom facilities, drinking at all hours of the day. It's not been a betterment to us. I think we can all agree that real estate is cyclical. 40 years ago, 30 years ago, East Beach had a whole different look to it. and it almost kept me from moving out to the Ocean View and Willoughby area. I happened to speak to somebody that was on the Planning Commission at that time, and I said, well, what's going on with all of this? And they said, well, there's lots of new stuff going on. We've got new property developments, new communities going in, lots of new neighborhoods going in, and we're really trying to change things for that area. What I fear is that what we're seeing now with all the conditional use permits over and over and more properties becoming non-owner occupied, we're seeing that cycle start to ramp up. And it won't be long before we'll see ourselves in the very position we were in 30 years ago. I think the city would be doing us a disservice in allowing more CUPs, especially without more beach control issues. We need to have, you know, it's great to call the police, but they've got better things to do. They've got a shooting to deal with, or a robbery to deal with, or a car theft to deal with. So a lot of times we don't get a response from the police because they've got other issues to take care of. So until that can be addressed, I don't see where it makes sense for us, where it's a service to the citizens of those areas, to add additional CUPs. And it's and something that Angie said, you know, you can swing a cat and see how many people have real estate licenses. I have had real estate brokerage license for 40 years. Vetting is one thing. You can look at people all day long on paper. It's not going to give you that, always give you the answer of what's going to happen. I've had, you know, I've been in property management for 30 years. I've seen some of my worst tenants be the ones that look the best on paper. So I don't know that that's always going to be your answer. So I appreciate your time. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much for your time. Catherine McLean, you do not wish to speak? Thank you very much for coming down. We have your opposition on record. Deborah Roundtree.
Doing with it too, I can't hardly see. I'm Debbie Roundtree. I live at 9611 Sixthview Street in Willoughby. I'm here on for support for my neighbors in Willoughby as a request to decline the conditional permit. Why I'm here is because essentially we moved into Willoughby 4 years ago. We built our forever home, and since we have lived there within the last year and a half, we've had a short-term rental next door to us. So I can attest to the loud music, the parking, the trash not being collected. Unfortunately, that homeowner that owned it was unpermitted. We now have another owner who is unpermitted. And unfortunately, they will tell you they're going to do one thing, but when they're out-of-state investors and they're not in the area and it's just for financial investment, it's different than when you're buying and living in a community for your forever home. The saturation is affecting our lifestyle. I didn't move to Willoughby to be across the street from the bay to endure the loud noise and the trash and the weed on the porch every night. I can't even take my grandkids out on the porch, and that's not what I wanted. It's my understanding that a conditional use permit is actually to gather the thoughts and recommendations from the existing homeowners that are already settled in, and it's a protection for us. And so that's what I'm asking you to do, is to protect us who've made it our neighborhood and our community. Look, I'm in the real estate business. I've been doing this for 36 years. I'm all for someone making a profit on real estate. That's what I do. But there has to be location restrictions and saturation and lifestyle. That's what POAs are for as well, so that you don't have certain conflicts in the neighborhood. We don't have those protections because we're not in a POA, so we look to you to enforce that. And a sign in the window, 20 minutes, heck, we can get gridlock down in Willoughby. You're not going to get an ambulance down there sometimes. I mean, that's another situation. We're also being asked as homeowners to take pictures, document, and call in reports to Norfolk Care. We do that, but that's not our job, and we certainly don't want to burden the police officers with those calls. They have enough to contend with other than dealing with a loud party that could get unruly. So therefore, I'm asking you, please consider, take the homeowners, permanent homeowners' interest to heart, because that's what we need. We need to keep it a residential neighborhood. I didn't move down here to live in a hotel complex. Nothing wrong with that, but that's not my intention, and I'm sure that that's not what my neighbor's intentions were 40 years ago. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Ms. Roundtree. We have two other opponents who do not wish to speak. Tom Holmes, thank you.
May I speak anyway?
Yes, sir.
Tom Holmes, 1162 Toller. I'd like for you to consider the atmosphere of where these B&Bs are placed and permitted. Say, for instance, if you have one downtown, you might be a business person, go to and from, you're not in a party atmosphere. When people come to the beach, they look at Willoughby Spit as undifferent than Nag's Head and Kitty Hawk and places like that. They think that they're there to shoot off fireworks, unvetted, things of that nature. It's a whole different atmosphere when you go to the beach to relax, have a party, raise a little cane. It's not like you're in a downtown residential neighborhood or something of that nature. It's an entirely different atmosphere, and the people that are attracted to these places in downtown, Vice, the beach or oceanfront, it's an entirely different atmosphere when you're renting for business, Vice, partying, relaxing, so forth in that nature. And I would like for you guys to consider that atmosphere, where you're going to be located at. Thank you.
Thank you. Also signed up in opposition but does not wish to speak, Rosemary Holmes. Thank you. That's the end of the speakers. We do have a rebuttal period. Both sides will have the opportunity to take 5 minutes. Ms. Lundy, you get to go first. Do you have anything else to say? Yeah.
I just wanted to thank my neighbors for taking the time to come, and I by no means want to make them feel uncomfortable. I understand a lot of them feel that they worked, their lives to, and this is their, this is their forever homes. But I do want to point out that we are on a public beach, and I just don't know if they do, oppose to this one permit. I understand they're saying it's one permit after another, but I just want them to consider it. We are on a public beach. So that's all. But I just want to assure them that I'll do the best that I can to make sure that there aren't any issues. And that's all. Thank you all.
Great. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. So now the opponents have collectively 5 minutes to speak. If anyone didn't get everything they need to say off their chest, Mr. McLean, would you like to come back up?
Thank you.
And collectively, you have 5 minutes. So if anybody else wants to come back up, please be considerate of their time. Thanks.
Thank you. James McLean, 1112 Toller Place. When these houses were built, they're only 10 feet apart, deck to deck. So where I am to you, so if 12 people or 10 people come, they're up till midnight talking, and then next week another group, and next week another. We're this close. So I don't know that feeds into all this. I'd like you all to just think about that too. It's residential. And when you're that close, I mean, it's going to interfere with our way of life every single day in the summer. And I just don't think I think that's what y'all are here to protect us from. And one other quick thing, the Urban Land Institute, I don't know if you all remember, but they made recommendations, I guess, 35 years ago about Willoughby. And they wanted, their big recommendation for Willoughby and Ocean View going forward was low density and own your occupancy. And they held out Toller Place as a model for that. They said, this is what everybody should aspire to if this is what the city of Norfolk wants to have happen. And they did, and it worked. And I think we're going the opposite way if we let this happen and happen next time and happen next time and happen next time.
Thank you, Mr. McLean. I apologize for cutting you off earlier. Just need to play by the rules.
It went so fast.
So we got, trust me, the opposite can be true, too. Do we have any of the other opponents wish to add to their comments? We have a little bit of time left. Commissioners, any comments or questions? Susan, call the vote, please.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Mr. Fraley?
I harbor a lot of the sentiments that those folks who are against this application harbor. I'm not a STR proponent by any means. In fact, not long ago I asked this commission if they would just stop considering STRs and let's consider what we've done over the last 3 years and what improvements can we make. We did have that retreat, and staff is considering now some additional guidelines with regard to how we handle STRs. I don't mean to belabor this, Mr. Chair, but I find Ocean View to be like these folks. As a lifelong resident here, if you hear oceanfront and beach, you think resort area. But Ocean View just happens to be a neighborhood in Norfolk that happens to be on the water. I don't necessarily see that as a resort destination. For me, I like this to continue to try to harbor that neighborhood of Ocean View that we all come to know and love over the years. Ocean View Amusement Park isn't there anymore. There's not a lot of activities that promote commercial, retail, and otherwise. Let's have a great time at this place. I think we need to be careful with STRs in all of our communities, and most especially Ocean View. And I think we do ourselves a disservice when we don't look very, very seriously at the impact that these types of dwelling units can have on a block or a community or a area of blocks in any particular neighborhood in our city. I'm voting no. And I would hope that I could encourage my commissioners to consider likewise. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Ms. Shelton?
No.
Mr. Bateman?
Yeah, I, like Commissioner Fraley here, struggle with this because the STR process and, the owner of the property has the legal right to, to do this. And there aren't really any areas that the city has given us as commissioners here to really put parameters on these. So we have been, in most cases, some of us, myself, voting for these, assuming it meets all the criteria and the staff recommend it. But I recognize Ocean View and the Willoughby area, and I recognize that a community comes together either for or against something. And this is a perfect example of how the community has rallied to do petitions, to come here today. And I'd like to see this representative of either for or against these because it helps us make the decision that we know is right. So I'm also going to vote no because I see the community has come together and has spoken. So,
Mr. McGee?
I agree with Mr. Bateman's comments. I've supported a number of short-term rentals, and the distinction here is that the community has come out very much opposed to this one, and so for that reason I vote no.
Ms. Sutter?
I have a little speech, too. I grew up in Ocean View, not far away from where this house is, and I also fished in that same bay with my father, and I think it's a beautiful thing that you have the opportunity to give that gift to him. I've also voted in favor of several short-term rentals, but this one I have to vote no. I want to see more of a detailed plan for the management of it, especially around booking and I think there is room for discernment in that regard. So I vote no.
And Mr. Murphy?
No, we'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thank you.
The next application, number 9, Crystal Palette Wine and Gourmet for conditional use permit for the following applications at 4500 Pretty Lake Avenue, Suite 104, A for the sale of alcoholic beverages. And I'm gonna note that B is no longer required, so we won't be considering that. The purpose of this request is to allow the restaurant to sell alcoholic beverages for off-premise consumption.
Thank you, Susan. As you indicated, this is not going to be a restaurant. This facility has a specialty retail ABC license, which allows them to sell it's called Gourmet. They're allowed to do tastings and private events and stuff like that, but people don't walk in and order food and walk out. So this is on the north side of Pretty Lake Avenue between 25th and 26th Bay Streets. The proposed use is consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates this site as residential mixed. The building is mixed use, containing both residential and commercial units. It is in the East Beach Plan Development Mixed Use Zoning District. They are requesting the sale of alcoholic beverages off premises. So this is an existing site that was given a conditional use permit in 2017 to operate as the same thing, a gourmet wine tasting shop and off-premise sales. They were originally operating in the suite to the right there. And then on the left-hand side of your screen is the building they are going to be expanding into. So knocking out an interior wall there and bringing more space for their event, for their tastings and their retail sales. Here's the floor plan. So again, on the right, you can see that there's some tasting areas and there's an area labeled kitchen, but it's not actually a kitchen. They do provide food with their tasting events, and they do sell cheeses and stuff like that. And then on the left side of your screen, you see more of a retail and more educational class area. So you can, on the screen here, we have the current hours of operation, which are 11 a.m. to 10 p.m. Monday through Saturday, and then 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. on Sunday. The new hours of operation would be 9 a.m. until 10 p.m. Monday through Saturday, and then 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. on Sunday. The existing facility is only 960 square feet, and with this expansion, they will be up to about 2,400 square feet. Under the previous conditional use permit, they weren't required to have an occupancy, but with their expansion, they're going to be doing 32 seats, 6 staff, and 8 retail space for a total of 46 occupants at any time. Given that the applicant is operating in good standing and is expanding a conforming use, staff recommends approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions in the staff report, including the hours of operation, container size, current on their taxes, and compliance with ABC regulations. Again, just to point out, as I did earlier, the container size the applicant is requesting to sell 187.5 milliliter bottles of champagne or sparkling wine that can be used to toast between two individuals. Whereas our normal ABC requirement is that for wine bottles to not be less than 375 milliliters.
Thanks, Rob. Any questions for Rob? Please stand by. We have the applicant, Crystal Cameron Shad.
Good afternoon. I'm Crystal Cameron Shad, 4643 Pleasant Avenue, Norfolk, Virginia, 23518. Thanks for having me here today. I own Crystal Palette Wine and Gourmet. We've been in business for 5 years this year, so making it through COVID was really standing still, so that's a great thing. And we are looking to expand our retail gifting, but most importantly, our classroom offerings. Wine education has always been at the heart of what we do. I hold a diploma credential from the Wine, Spirit, and Education Trust out of London. I'm one of 10,000 people worldwide to have this credential. It is considered the gold standard in wine education. I'm also a certified sommelier. We have been offering the WSET courses and qualifications for the past couple of years, and this expansion would make us really the first true classroom wine academy setting in the Hampton Roads region. We're currently operating under the Capital Wine School for the WSET courses, so this expansion project would be mostly for class offerings, private events, and just really helping our community with people in the hospitality trade and wine enthusiasts around the region with the professional credentials as well as wine enthusiasts looking to learn more about wine before they travel and things of that nature. We've been voted the best wine shop in coastal Virginia 4 years running since we've opened. We love the city. We live in the community. We're 2 blocks away. So we're really looking forward to expanding and offering more services for our community. Apologize about the restaurant thing that was listed. We were trying to figure out how to appropriately be zoned because we are offering on-premise for tastings, but it's strictly monitored. With WSET, for example, we have a strict spitting policy, so when we do 10, 12 wines for the educational qualifications, consumers are not allowed to actually consume the wine. It's all about the academics of the wine. And then we are regulated under ABC, under their gourmet license, which allows us to conduct tastings for educational purposes. So that's what we're looking to do in this space.
Very good. Congratulations on your success.
Oh, thank you.
Any questions for the applicant? We have no one signed up to speak in favor or against your application, but thank you very much for coming downtown.
Thank you for having me.
Comments, questions? Susan.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Fraley?
I vote aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Yeah, I think this is a perfect example of another small business success, and to make it through 5 years where most small businesses fail in the first 5 years, and you're expanding, so I think this is great for the city and great for the Ocean View community too, so I vote yes.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thank you.
Item number 10, Afterglow Brewery for the following conditional use permits at 2330 Bowdens Ferry Road, A, for the production of craft beverages, and B, for live entertainment. The purpose of these requests is to allow for a brewery to operate with limited entertainment options.
Thank you, Susan. This is located on the southeast corner of West 25th Street and Bowdens Ferry Road. It's located in the IP Configure warehouse there. You'll see on the screen the entire property is outlined in red. Outlined in a light blue color is the area of the facility that the brewery will be operating in. You can see it's a very small portion of the overall facility. The proposed use is consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates this site as commercial. It is located in the CC Community Commercial Zoning District. They are required to get a conditional use permit for the production of craft beverages and live entertainment. So here's a picture of the front of the site. There on the screen here, where the arrow indicates, they're just going to be in the leftmost bay. There is opportunity at some point in the future for them to possibly expand into the right bay, but for now it's just going to be storage. Here's a picture of the backyard area, I'm going to call it, where they'll be having their outdoor entertainment and where they'll be having outdoor seating available to the public. Here's their floor plan. They have designated brewing areas and bar areas, and as well as some seating areas. And then on the left-hand side of your screen, you can see the outdoor space where they have the entertainment area set up, as well as that outdoor seating. I did want to go over briefly the entertainment options that'll be available to them. They've requested for live band, trivia, karaoke, comedy, yoga, and movies. Their hours of operation are 3 to 9 Monday through Thursday, 2 to 10 on Friday, 12 to 10 on Saturday, and 12 to 8 on Sundays. The total occupancy will be 240 people. 89 of those will be indoor seats and 146 outdoor seats. Given that the proposed use is consistent with the vision for the rail yards at Lambert's Point, staff recommends approval subject to the following conditions. The hours of operation, both indoor and outdoor, their capacity, the specified types of entertainment, compliance with ABC regulations, staying current on their taxes, and bike parking. The applicant and the property owner have worked together to put additional bike parking on site towards the Elizabeth River Trail, but they're also going to be putting it right next to their facility.
Thanks, Rob. Any questions for Rob?
Mr. Chairman, if I might.
Of course.
That outdoor area, the grassy area, how much space is that? Do you know?
I do not know, sir.
We'll ask the owners. Okay.
We might. Anybody else have a question for Rob? Is the applicant here? Okay. Showed up a little bit late to sign up. Well, we need to hear from you, so please give us your name and mailing address and add it to the record. Thank you.
Josh Evans, 4310 Colonial Avenue, Norfolk, Virginia, 23508. I've always wanted to start a brewery. I've been working for Centera for the past 10 years. I'm a physical therapist. I do home care. So if any of you have had a hip or knee replacement, you've probably seen me. So for this brewery, I kind of started talking about a year ago with the owner of IP Configure. Just didn't have the funding for it. And then over the last year, I've gotten it. So we want to make it a family-friendly environment where you can bring your kids, hang out. We have all that space out back, which a lot of the breweries, I know other places like Cova have a lot of space. My kids love going there. They have a sandbox and some other stuff. We want to make it super friendly, have some live bands. We talked to the Civic League, got 100% approval from them. The only thing that they had mentioned was crime and stuff. The police were there at the meeting, and they said usually at the breweries, because we close by 10, we don't usually have a problem with that. Also, we want to be a staple in the rail yard that's coming up. We want to help build that place up and, you know, give back to the community.
Very good.
And that was one of my questions as well. How close are you to the rail yard development?
I mean, we're like West 25th. We're right there. So I don't know exactly what I see, like all the signs for it. So we're like right there. They're demolishing the stuff behind us where I understand they're putting an Aldi or a Lidl, like grocery store, which is supposed to be part of it. We have Sanctuary Tacos right next door to us. So there will be a food option next to us. And they've been very friendly to us too and super supportive the whole time. So it's good to have good neighbors.
So you propose to use that open space that we saw in the presentation for benches, tables, and things of that sort?
Yeah, we would like to do benches, tables. We're talking about building like a bocce ball court, you know, just have some games outside, you know, that families or people that are coming can play. You know, like I said, we'd also like to have a kid area with maybe some playground equipment. My landlord had said he would be happy to kind of like, you know, discuss that and, you know, just have something for everybody to do.
I have a question.
Yes,
you mentioned
ma'am.
About partnering with the community. Could you say more about that?
Yeah, so over the, I've been renting Bluebird Park for a long time, so it's really funny. I've seen that building like there forever. So I run the local Wiffle Ball League of Hampton Roads, and my buddy runs the Kickball League of Hampton Roads. We do a lot of stuff for CHKD. I've personally worked for CHKD. I like to give back to the hospital, but if there's any other causes or that, you know, people, like I know for me, for instance, we'll always have like circles or something come to us through kickball or wiffle ball and be like, hey, like, can we do a tournament, like a 1-day tournament? And then we'll give them all the equipment. We already have it. It doesn't cost us anything. And our gift will be like, we'll pay the city to rent the field. And then they get all the money that we make from people running those events. So we can do stuff with that, whether it's, you know, having an event where we can create a beer for like a good cause or something and then donate a portion of that back to whatever the cause is that we're trying to accomplish or, you know, give back to.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. No problem.
Any other questions for the applicant? You are in close proximity to the neighborhood. Be very cautious with that live entertainment because that Civic League, not that one in particular, the Civic Leagues will turn on you in a heartbeat
yep.
if you disrupt the peace.
Yes,
so.
We had a good talk with them and told them we would, you know, if they had any problems with us, please let us know. They said they really missed Bold Mariner being there. And so, you know, so that was one of the things they were super excited about us coming, you know. But we told them if they have any problems, like, they can come to us, let us know. We're super friendly, and you know, we're going to try to be the best neighbors we can.
Great. Glad you made it downtown.
Yeah.
Yes.
Quick comment, question. So thank you for, you know, we've obviously shared the same dream in the past.
Yes.
But what is Afterglow?
So, so for me, I made that name. It's the good after the bad, or the light that shines through, or the feeling of accomplishment. And to me, it's just been a dream. And working through Sentara, doing the home care for the last however, and going through this whole COVID thing kind of burned me out as a medical professional. We were transitioned as physical therapists basically into nurses, and we would go into people's houses with COVID because there was no room at the hospital. So having two kids, a almost 1-year-old and an almost 4-year-old now, it's never the right time, I feel like, but my wife and I talked about it, and for me it is now, you know, so that's where the name came from. Yeah.
Great. Anything else? Super.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
We have no proponents or opponents. So any comments, commissioners? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye, and moving on to the beer and wine portion of our meeting, we have Mermaid Winery.
Item number 11, Mermaid Winery for the following conditional use permits at 101 Granby Street, A for a banquet hall, B for a production of craft beverages, C live entertainment, D restaurant with alcoholic beverages and extended hours of operation, and E sale of alcoholic beverages off-premise. The purpose of these requests is to allow the operation of a banquet hall with live entertainment and extended hours, their production of craft beverages and alcoholic beverages, and for off and on-premise consumption. Okay, venturing into downtown, So this site is located on the northwest corner of Main Street and Granby Street. It's been used as several restaurants previously. This applicant currently operates an establishment both on 22nd Street, and she's also got one in Virginia Beach Boulevard on Laskin. The property is in the DBC, which is the Downtown Business Center. And all of these uses, the banquet hall, the production of craft beverages, the live entertainment, restaurant with extended hours, and sale of off-premise, are permitted in that district with a conditional use permit. It sounds like a lot of conditional use permits and a complicated thing, but this is exactly the operation that she has at our other locations, so she really truly is just moving those operational aspects to this location. It's a little bit bigger. So I wanted to show here her existing location, what she was approved during. She does have a CUP at that location and at her new location. So the hours of operation at her current location, 11 to 2. I think she realized she really probably never stayed open that late. So more realistically, the restaurant would be from 11 o'clock a.m. till 10:30 p.m. 7 days a week. And then she is indicating for New Year's she would like to be open until 1. So that does go beyond that. For the banquet hall, a little bit later, 11 o'clock a.m. until 12 o'clock midnight, 7 days a week. And again, with that option for New Year's to remain open till 1. For the entertainment, similar to what she had at her location, live band and disc jockey, the only two things she's adding is karaoke and comedian. The occupancy, so again, a little bit smaller in her current location. So for the restaurant, and for this, there is a mezzanine. There's some building code issues with using that right away. Her goal is to be able to use that once she can sort that through. So we've got a couple of different capacities here. So with no mezzanine opening now, it would be 59 seats indoors, 28 seats outdoors, and 107 total capacity. When she is allowed to use the mezzanine, the outdoor seats don't change. That will always be 28. But the number of seats increases to 87, and the total capacity will be at 135. That's for the restaurant. For the banquet hall, again, increase 91 seats indoors, still 28 outdoors, a total of 139 capacity. When she gets the mezzanine, that will increase to a total capacity of 163, increasing the number of seats to 115. So with those conditions, staff is recommending that the application be approved subject to all of the conditions that are standard in our conditional use permits, which pertain to hours of operation, specifying the type of entertainment, the capacity, the compliance with all ABC requirements, and that she remain current on her ABC taxes, current taxes. Any questions I can answer?
I think you're clear for now. Thank you. The applicant is here, Jennifer Eichert.
Hi. Hi, my name's Jennifer Eichert. I reside at 305 Brook Avenue, Unit 201 in Norfolk, 23510. And that was a lot. So thank you, Ms. Pollock and your team. That was, it does sound like a lot. And everything that we are proposing for this downtown location is just relocating the Ghent location to downtown. So private events, wine. One thing we're adding on is liquor, so that is a little different. But then the hours of operation will just remain 12 to 10, and we're closed on Mondays. So I'm not sure if you have any questions. Sorry, I know
some of us are more familiar with the operation than others, but I'll ask.
No, that's fine. I know it was a lot, so.
No, we're good. We've seen it like the presentation three times. We got our minds around it.
Okay. Okay.
So, commissioners, any comments or questions? Great. You don't mind just sitting tight for another minute?
I'm sorry?
You can have a seat.
Okay, thank you.
Unless you have something else to say?
Nope, thank you so much.
Great, thank you. No one signed up to speak in favor or against this application. So, commissioners, any comments or questions for Susan or the applicant? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the request subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
I'd just like to say thank you again for continuing to invest in the city of Norfolk. Your business is great. Thank you. I vote yes also.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thank you. Item 12.
Item number 12, the Slow Dive Gallery for the following conditional use permits at 117 East Princess Anne Road. A, for a restaurant with alcoholic beverages and extended hours of operation, and B, live entertainment. The purpose of these requests is to allow the restaurant to operate with live entertainment until 2 o'clock a.m. Okay, the Slow Dive Gallery. So this location, this operator may sound familiar to you. The site is located on the south side of East Princess Anne between Monticello Ave and Granby Street. The applicant received a conditional use permit and was operating. Things got a little confusing with COVID. The conditional use permit did expire. He has been closed for a bit. He would now like to reopen. He is applying for a new conditional use permit for essentially the same operation that he was operating previously. So the applicant does propose to operate until 2 o'clock a.m. with live entertainment. And he would be required to get two conditional use permits, one for the extended hours and one for the live entertainment. So the hours of operation and the sale of alcoholic beverage and entertainment, all the same thing, 8 o'clock a.m. until 2 o'clock a.m., 7 days a week. And entertainment, again, same thing he had before. I did want to mention one thing that may be new is the board games. He didn't have that before, but he has added that. And that's something more that we've seen more and more of, so that was added to the application. The occupancy, again, that was the same as before. Total of 38 seats indoors, 8 outdoor seats. He did have outdoor seating before, but he does need to obtain an encroachment for that. He has removed those seats until he does get his encroachment for that. And then a total capacity of 49 seats. This is the floor plan. It's a pretty small space, you can tell from the capacity. So on this one, I mentioned before that the applicant is requesting the same hours of operation until 2 o'clock a.m. Concerned by city staff is we did receive some complaints regarding noise from the outside, as well as doors being left over and noise. In addition, I think you all know there are some issues in downtown right now. So as a result of that, we're starting off our recommendation by recommending approval, but recommending that the establishment close by 12 o'clock midnight. Also, as we do with applications where we have had maybe some issues, we do kind of put them on a probationary period and have the conditional use permit expire again after 2 years. So that is included in this recommendation of approval. But other than that, again, the conditions are pretty standard. We limit the live entertainment, the capacity, compliant with both the ABC requirements and making sure their taxes are current. And with those conditions, staff is recommending approval.
Great. Thank you, Susan. Any questions for Susan? Thanks. Please stand by. Before we get started, I want to thank everybody who came downtown to City Hall for this application and have waited to the end of the meeting. I know it can be really test your patience, so thank you very much. First up, we have the applicant, Charles Burnell.
Good afternoon, commissioners. My name is Charles Burnell. I reside at 406 Ridgely Road in Norfolk. I've been an artist, creative citizen of Norfolk for about 15 years now. I chose Norfolk over all the other cities in our region. As you guys noted earlier, this is a cultural hub, and I've been not only blessed and lucky to be at the forefront of this creative culture, but also able to help create very important pillars to this, such as the Neon District. A previous business that I created and operated in the Neon District was Work Release, which was very similar to this business model and art space that also included an ABC imprint. We operated with a 400-person capacity, for several years without any incidences of violence, any incidences of issues with the city. And, you know, what I'm hoping for now is that we can continue to operate. We've been closed for about 3 months, as Susan mentioned, because of the expiration of our conditional use, which we received during COVID and was delayed. So we only operated approximately for about 10 months under this conditional use permit. And so there was a bit of a mix up in dates. I'm appreciative of her help and guidance through this process. The one thing I did request, in addition to being able to operate to 2 a.m., was that we take out the sunset clause. As you can see, it's caused me some issues. We've operated, honestly, without issues, and I can detail them with the police reports that I've pulled and the calls to that block. And I mainly ask that we remove that sunset clause, as Mr. Melita has noted in work sessions with City Council previously, when they've discussed this sunset clause of 2 years, is that we need to build in a window so that some businesses don't have to suffer that, because business owners won't invest in our community if they know that at the end of 2 years they can have their entire operation disrupted, as I have had. And so I appreciate that foresight and that statement in a previous City Council session, and that's why I ask for that sunset clause to be removed if possible. Additionally, I'd like to address the calls to service. As Susan mentioned, you know, we haven't been open since August. I reached out to her with my concern after the shooting that happened on Plume Street to see how we could be leaders in our community for nightlife. I've also worked directly since they've gotten to town with Safe Night Out to help them craft their reports and to understand, you know, what we can do as a community to create and make sure that Norfolk nightlife is safe, but also not hinder the growth of our young creative culture, because they are so dependent on these spaces often. If we don't have them, then they go to the fringes of our cities and to unsafe spaces to experience them. And so what I do have is in my calls for service, though there are 7 that have taken place in the time that I've been open, only 2 of these actually happened during my hours of operation, and that is the 325 and 326 weekend, which, if you note, is the weekend after the shooting that happened at Chicho's, where 4 people were wounded or murdered. I honestly was happy to hear from the first responders in our community, because one of the things that we know is important to our community and to our space is being accountable to our neighbors. So at that time, when I first had this noise disturbance on Friday, I offered my phone number to the complainant and anyone else. I have a great relationship with Officer Fentress in my community as well, and she reaches out to me oftentimes for things unrelated to my space, because when we came to our block, if you guys are familiar with this block of Princess Anne, there's an abandoned gas station on a corner which has had many issues with our homeless population of homeless folks, as well as a convenience store which also has its own share of foot traffic and some issues. There was also, at the time when I came to the block and first filed my conditional use permit, an outlaw biker gang operating an illegal ABC establishment and strip club in a place across the street. We had 7 shootings in 6 months before I opened, and we personally not only intervened when the Norfolk police were unable to get them out and the city at large, but I communicated directly with their landlord as a representative of the Neon District, and he immediately took action. We got them out of there. We've reduced the violence and the illegal activity on the block by easily 90% to 95%. And now in that space is occupied a young girls dance studio that serves community of color under the age of 16. They are championship and award-winning dancers. That window is, instead of being blocked from view, it's full of trophies that these young ladies have won all over the community. And we share our parking lot across the street with them whenever they need a place to expand and to dance. Additionally, in that gas station on the corner, we immediately engage the population of citizens in Norfolk that are living homeless. We not only helped them find jobs with us and other places, but we also got them housing, not only at the temporary encampment that was at the Greyhound station, but also at the new place that you guys have all provided over next to the Burger King. And so we see it as part of our civic duty. When we exist somewhere, it's about not only bringing new folks to the block, but including everyone that already exists there. And so I hope that our work, not only in the Neon District to do this, but also on our block, can speak for itself. And I can continue to help not only lead the creative community and the working class folks that believe in arts and entertainment in our city, but even the folks that are sometimes left out of these conversations. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Commissioners, any questions for the applicant?
Mr. Brunell, thank you for being with us. Have there been any capacity issues or fire marshal concerns?
Of the weekend of 325 and 326, this 26 was actually a fire marshal's visit in response to the issues in downtown. When they performed a count, we were absolutely within our capacity. And the issues about the patio capacity were resolved at the last meeting that I had with Ms. Pollack and ABC and all the other officers, where the fire marshal said, well, while there are 8 seats demarcated, the capacity of the patio is only determined by the capacity of the establishment. So while it says 8 seats, it's not 8 people on the patio. It's as long as I'm within my 49 with my staff and with my guests, then I'm with compliance.
Thank you for that. I've also heard there's some concerns about noise, and I've had some difficulty understanding exactly where that's coming from or what the nature of that is. I think you might have touched on it in your earlier comments. Could you elaborate a little bit more on that, as well as speak to what steps you've taken to prevent that?
Yes, sir. So what I do as a rule of note is any of my security staff or staff in general, they're prepared with decibel reading meters, whether it's on their phone as an app or the meter itself. We make sure and we try to maintain always that the exterior noise from our establishment is under 56 decibels, which is absolutely the code. It is worth noting that on-street volume, cars driving by, buses driving by, often exceeds 110 decibels, which is also the code after those hours. And so we are very prepared and adamant with not only the folks that we're working with, whether it's live performance or whether it's folks on the patio, that we don't exceed those decibels. And when I first heard about the noise complaints, because it was sort of strange to us because there's residents, they're not very close. It's within about a block away. But with the gunplay and the loud music and the exotic dancing that was happening at the outlaw biker gang's hideout, it was strange for us to understand that we maybe somehow have more of an impact. But I reached out immediately once I heard from folks in the community that I talk with, Mary Miller in downtown and a few other folks that told me the complaint had emanated from an email directed by one citizen on Princess Anne to Councilwoman Doyle. I reached out to Councilwoman Doyle and I asked her if she'd like to meet me, because we had never got a chance to meet in person. And she outlined to me that yes, while there were no Norfolk Cares complaints or any noise complaints beyond the late March date, that it was one citizen in Prince Edward that had reached out to her and said, sometimes I hear bass at night or I hear people. And unfortunately, I haven't been able to engage them directly or let them engage me so that I could try to mitigate it within something that makes them happy. But I did reach out to other folks within the neighborhood, and I'm not sure, I know you guys might have received a myriad of letters of support, but I did reach out to some folks I knew that frequented our establishment or that knew of our establishment in the same Prince Edward neighborhood, and I received one of the letters of support that I don't think made it to you guys was Andrew Cronin of 247 Prince Edward Way. And I'm happy to pass this around in case if you don't want me to read the whole thing. But it's, basically, we've owned our home in Ghent Commons neighborhood since 2018. We lived there before Slow Vibe existed and have lived there since they've been in operation. I've noticed no ill effects from living in proximity, specifically no uptick in noise, trash, traffic, violence, music, or any unwanted intrusion. On the contrary, I view the addition of Slow Dive to be a welcome addition to our corner of the city. And he also asked that we be evaluated like any other cultural institution, for example, the Glass Studio, which we've been so happy to have as a growing resident of the Neon District since we created it. Because we provide a unique and important curated exhibitions and events that are meaningful and necessary. It's my hope as a citizen of Norfolk and a neighbor to their establishment that they may continue with their mission for many years to come. And so, yeah, hopefully that answers your questions. And if anyone else has one, I'm happy to address them as well.
It looks like we're good for the moment, but please stand by.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair, since we have him here. Staff has recommended a closing time of midnight. Are you comfortable with that?
No, sir. If I'm asked to close at midnight, which is one of the reasons I've been closed down now, when we expired, the initial conversation was that we'd be able to work together to get this renewal in so that I could continue to operate. When the violence happened on Plume Street, it was, I think, an order maybe came down from the city manager that wasn't feasible. Immediately I was told I could that my zoning certificate was attached to my conditional use permit, so I couldn't even operate as a restaurant or or till midnight, so I had to then apply for a restaurant zoning permit, which I did immediately. They said it usually takes about 2 weeks. I got it within about 3 weeks. At that point, I had lost a lot of staff, lost some income, but we immediately were able to reopen within those hours, and it was not feasible for us. Specifically with the business model that we've come into this with, I have a wide range of operating hours because we do things all different times of the day. My main focus is Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, those later evenings, simply because that's where I can engage young people in this demographic in a way that juxtaposes the relevant entertainment they believe in to the art that I know is so integral to making them a part of this. You know, we joke, but it's very serious that we're not just creating nightlife space, we're creating holy spaces. Because of the inclusion of art and creative energy there, these young folks take care of one another. We build that into our culture. They take care of the community around them, and the art and the need to meet them where they're at is integral to that. So, sir, I don't think I could honestly operate in the function I need to and to make the money I need to stay open if I was to have to close at midnight.
Well, a follow-up question. I thought I understood in your presentation that due to COVID, you've only been able to operate for 10 months under your current CUP. Is that correct?
That's correct, sir.
But you had 7 calls for service during that 10 months.
Actually, the 7 calls for service, yes, sir. And that, to note, I don't think that's directly to my address. So to note, my address is one of the only ones down there that has a number on the building. But I also know that in those calls for service were included car accidents, a domestic violence issue that I know happened up the street at the Ghent Love Mart. And so I think generally we may be used as a landmark, but the only call for service that actually came in during my operating hours were on the March weekend after the shooting at Chicho's. And one of those calls for service wasn't called in. It was simply the bar task force that was reconvening, visiting every establishment.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? Please stand by.
Thank you so much.
So we had several people speak up as proponents. As a reminder, you have 3 minutes. Please state your name and mailing address when you come to the podium and address your comments to the commissioners. Carrie Ann Weinberg.
Hello, commissioners. My name is Carrie Ann Weinberg, and I reside at 406 Ridgely Road in Norfolk. I'm going to keep this brief. Charles is my partner in several different work aspects, but also on a personal level. So I've been heavily involved in watching his progression and what he does with the community over the last decade. And he has been not only a resident, but a business owner, a mentor for so many within our city. He's incredibly active and a positive community member in our, specifically like downtown Norfolk, but in the region as a whole. We've ran, as he noted, work release in the Neon District. We've put on many, many events throughout our community. And then he's operated Slow Dive most recently with zero incidents or any issues of violence or anything of the sort for, again, over a decade. And Charles is really, he has a gift for bringing communities and people together of all backgrounds. So he creates these spaces and experiences that just radiate positivity and safety and belonging for all in a way that just amazes me daily as a partner watching it, but I think the community as a whole. And, you know, that's anywhere from artists to politicians coming to our spaces, architects, ad execs, famous musicians, building contractors, longshoremen, young, old, every demographic comes into to Slow Dive, but all of his spaces, and everyone kind of has been able to create or live in harmony in a way that I don't see happen often. He has created safe spaces that are very valuable and needed in our community, especially in the nightlife timeframe. Whenever, as other things even go, then that leaves a lack of any nightlife that's regulated to be able to happen within our city. So it's just really important for Slow Dive and places like Slow Dive to continue in some capacity. And our city is just fortunate to have him and Slow Dive and the entire staff and crew, several of them that are here
within our city to help create that safe space for people. And then I just, you know, so I just wanted to say how important that is to me, to our city, and I hope that you guys all see that as well. There were several recommendations by staff to make many changes to his application, the sunset clause, the hours of operation, as well as a few other minor changes. And a lot of those would really, really affect his ability to continue to operate by bringing in money and paying staff, all of that during those times. And I would ask that you think of that, not just for him, but for others in the future. And thank you all so much.
Thank you very much. Drew Unvarsky.
Good afternoon. I'm Drew Unvarsky, 615 Maury Avenue. Sent you all a letter late last evening. Sorry for getting it to you so late. I want to share those comments here in case you didn't see them, but more broadly for the community here, especially anybody who may be opposed, and add just a little bit more context to those comments. So first, I live, as I said, on Maury Avenue. It's about six blocks away from Slow Dive. Before I lived on Maury, I lived on in the 200 block of Princess Anne Road, about four houses down from where Slow Dive is today. And I know all the problems that we were referring to earlier, the derelict gas stations, the homeless population, the trash, the soliciting that happens there. It's really quite disturbing. And to see that a business was opening there, I was really thrilled. When I found out what it was and who it was, I was even more thrilled to see that that was happening there. So, and then maybe other bit of context I shared in my letter, and I'll read it to you here. I'm a resident, a business owner multiple times over here in the city, and a property owner multiple times in the city. To put that into context, directly in the properties that I own and have invested in here in the city, I've invested nearly $30 million in the city towards growing specifically a creative class that will help the city realize its full potential. And so I hope you recognize that in the context of these contexts, or these notes rather. Dear Planning Commission, I'm here today to share with you my strong support for Slow Dive Gallery and their conditional use permit renewal. I extend the support in my capacity as a resident, property owner, and business owner in the city of Norfolk. Slow Dive is an important addition to Norfolk's creative culture. Through space and programming, they provide opportunities for artists and musicians to create, connect, and share their talents with the broader community. Having held memorable company gatherings at Slow Dive and knowing it to be a favorite spot amongst our employees, I can confidently assert that Slow Dive is adding value and character to our city. Further, I know owner Charles Brunel to be a hardworking champion for the arts in the community, as you've heard here today, both through his business and his volunteer efforts. I've seen Charlie raise his hand time and time again to assist with projects and events and to call others to action, all in the name of improving our city. I very much respect and appreciate that the city's working to curb violence associated with certain nightlife and establishments. It is needed in specific instances where the volume and significance of those events is clear and outsized. But to paint with such a broad brush as to restrict businesses like Slow Dive that do not demonstrate that history is not only unreasonable, it's dangerous to the and limits the future of our future potential of our city. As an employer seeking to attract and retain the world's best talent in the city, I can't underscore this message strongly enough. It's critically important that we enable and support creative businesses like Slow Dive, who champion the arts, welcome diverse communities, and appeal strongly to young audiences. Put simply, we need more businesses like Slow Dive in our city, not less. Thank you all.
Thank you. Next is Jocelyn Battle. Justin, I'm sorry.
Good evening. I'm Justin Battle, 1109 Granby Street. Okay. I do represent the cultural aspect of Slow Dive. I had the pleasure of meeting Charles when I was 19 years old. Growing up in a crime-ridden area of Newtown Road, you would know if you're not going to be going to college, it would be easy to get sucked down a road of crime, drugs, and all the distractions that continue to grow in that area. From that, I went under his wing for quite a amount of time. Done many events at the Hermitage Museum, Chrysler Museum, and till now also I am a martial arts instructor that does enjoy many nights with some of the fathers. Sometimes we go out to Slow Dive and maybe have an occasional drink, talk about some things, and then I help train their children, which is a group of about 30 kids that we have here. Also, I have a 9-year-old that comes to stay at my house on every other weekend, and I live on the corner where I can see Slow Dive. So there hasn't been, for me, any kind of complaints with any noise. My fiance has no complaints with us. We have sound sleep at nighttime, and we do enjoy the growing experience that Slow Dive has brought to that sector of Norfolk, being as we have been condo owners on Granby Street, a block away from where previous shootings have happened. We since have relocated until we can find a property within the Ghent Square area that we can purchase and start a family. So as everyone else would say, it is a great opportunity to have Slow Dive available for a lot of us, because it is an extended part of the arts community that has been able to grow and give people a chance. You have Grammy-nominated, Grammy Award-winning musicians. You have the arts. My daughter enjoys multiple events in the afternoon. And again, I can circle back to at the nighttime, you know, living there. It's a lot safer for a lot of us just to walk over and have a casual drink and go home. So, with your review, I'm sure that, you know, we can all agree, and I hope that you guys can find a place to be able to allow this establishment to continue to be a beacon for everybody to grow and enjoy the experience.
All right. Thank you, Justin. Thank you. Michael Cox.
Hello, everybody. Hope you're doing well. My name is Michael Cox. I live at 925 Brandon Avenue here in Norfolk, Virginia. Hope it's okay. I do have some notes that I took from today, but appreciate you all hearing this. I am the operations manager at Slow Dive. I apologize for being dressed down. I'm supposed to be somewhere else right now. But Slow Dive has been a blessing to me, truly. I've been trying to work with Charles for years. I've been impressed by what he's been able to do and accomplish. It's definitely a safe space to this area. One thing that I've continued to hear be mentioned is Plan Norfolk 2030. And if you do look at Plan Norfolk, there's plenty of mentionings for things like Slow Dive to exist. And I think that we're making it hard for things that are being put under the umbrella of nightlife to exist. Plan Norfolk says it's a general plan referred to as a comprehensive plan in the Code of Virginia. It is a local government's guide to future physical, social, and economic development. Comprehensive plans are not meant to function as land use regulations in themselves, but instead serve as the basis for local land use decisions through the provision of a long-range vision of the community and in the future. With that being said, I think that we don't have a clear direction of what's happening with the creative opportunities for people in this area. Mighty Dream is something that we all are excited about coming to downtown Norfolk. A lot of the artists and creatives that you are seeing be featured that are local artists are constituents that come to Slow Dive. They were given opportunities by Charles. Their only opportunities are in spaces like this. So it's very interesting that the city picks and chooses when they want to give these people a platform. When these people just want a place to be able to operate and do their thing on a smaller scale, it's inconvenient. Another thing is that a wide variety of cultural and recreational opportunities that will lead to a fun and healthy lifestyle for a diverse population. When we are mentioning wineries and breweries, we get the easy okay every time. And I think it's certain entities that are being allowed to exist and certain ones in demographics that are kind of being limited by what they can do. And this is in Plan Norfolk 2030. Operating until 2 a.m. is something that we definitely need to have, because we work in tangent with multiple businesses and we get the majority of our business around that time of 12 o'clock. So I think that it is extremely limiting to not only us, but what we can do to work with other businesses to provide these creative and economic opportunities. Just like Charles said, I myself also am not from Norfolk originally. I'm from Virginia Beach. And there is definitely a stigma of what you can and can't do out there. I moved to Norfolk for more creative and economic opportunities, and we are pitching that Norfolk is the cultural hub of Hampton Roads. And I think that we can be, but we have to continue to work with the people that are actually attempting to do these, provide these creative resources and provide them more resources, not less. We see it in Georgia, where they provide money into their film and everything. But thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Think about it.
Next, Carla Leonzo. Okay. In support on the record, Bruce Longman must have had to leave. A proponent. Also a proponent, do not wish to speak, Thomas Wilkinson. Great. Your support is noted. We have a couple of people who signed up and did not note whether they are proponents or opponents, so help me sort this out. Marquita Castano? Gone. Charles A. Brown II? Got it. We have one undecided, Tristan Langhorn.
Yeah, I didn't know what I was filling out.
Thank you. We have one opponent, Susan Longman.
Good afternoon.
Hi.
My father is Bruce Longman, and he owns the building that's at 1216 Granby Street, along with the surrounding parking lots.
Great. Do you mind stating your name and mailing address?
I'm so sorry. Susan Longman. My mailing address is 4020 Catesby Jones Drive, Hampton, Virginia, 23669.
Okay.
My father, Bruce Longman, who had to leave, owns the building at 1216 Granby Street, and I'm a real estate broker, and I manage that property for him. He really has the largest parcel of real estate directly across the street from the Slow Dive Gallery. And it includes his commercial office building where his dental practice used to be housed, the large parking lot directly behind his building for his tenants and their customers and clients, another parking spot at the corner of Granby and 13th Street, and an additional parking lot that has actually been mentioned by the gentleman who was running Slow Dive, which is directly across the street from Slow Dive, which is currently locked up. And we locked that parking lot because it was actually being utilized without permission by his patrons. And very nice group in Slow Dive. Never had a problem with them. I've actually walked in there sometimes in the evening when they've had events, when they first opened, to say, hey, you can't have people just filling up our parking lot because it doesn't belong to you. And when that didn't work, we went the route of roping it off. And then for a period of time, they rented the space from us, but that lease is now expired. So I'm not sure what they're doing for parking, but that's a big concern. Trash is a big concern. I can't speak to the noise complaints because I'm not there at 9, 10, 11 o'clock at night. But I think that it's great to be a mentor. It's great to have a business like this that he's running. And it's also good to be a good neighbor. And we haven't felt like it's been a good neighborly situation because we feel like they've trespassed on our property. The dance group that he's mentioning, that's our property that they're on without our permission. So these are the concerns that we have, my father and I.
Great. Thank you very much for coming downtown. We now enter the rebuttal period. Charles Burnell, if you have anything to add, you have 5 minutes.
Thank you all again. Charles Burnell, 406 Ridgely Road. It's actually grateful to finally meet Susan in person. We've communicated over the last couple of years very often. It's kind of shocking to me to hear that we've used the parking lot unauthorized because I've had a lease with her and for a couple of years paid $500 a month for that parking lot that she's now claiming they locked up, which I actually put the chain back across it when the lease expired and returned the key to her. The price went up, you know, a year or so into our lease by about $75. So for the last year, I've paid $575 a month for 12 parking spaces that I'm not required to have because I already have enough parking for my 49 capacity. We just wanted to provide an amenity of parking and a safe place for folks to park in downtown. And so I'm very shocked to hear that we've used it illegally and that they've locked it up because I was actually the person that returned the chain to cover it about a month or two ago when the lease expired. Namely, as it was a month-to-month lease, it was let go because of it was one more accessory expense that we couldn't afford being closed after hours. So I'm happy to see and meet her in person finally. It's very shocking to hear that we were using it illegally, because I have a lease for the lot, and I can demonstrate that, as well as checks that were cashed monthly for 2 years now.
Anything else you'd like to speak to?
I just want to thank you guys all for your time, not only the folks that came here to support us today, but all of y'all. I know you have several endeavors in your own lives, and the time that you commit to our city to make sure that we are not only fulfilling the important processes of bureaucracy and creating a safe place overall for all citizens, but also allowing folks like me to come and speak our heart, and these young folks and the people that have supported. I just want to thank you all for your time and for your leadership.
Great. If you would just stand by.
Yep, certainly.
Before you leave, Mr. Brunel, can I have a question?
Yes, sir.
We probably need to thank you, too, for all your efforts in our city to make it be all like we can be. Appreciate that. This parking space issue. Are you going to seek to try to lease that space again?
So currently we have three spaces leased from the cleaners across the street that provide parking for the residents. The building is a mixed-use building that has two apartments located in it. So while I would absolutely be willing to rent that space again if needed, we already have the adequate parking that we need to be open. And, it just really depends on if Susan feels like we were taking advantage of her, because I don't honestly, it's news to me, and I'll absolutely send her an email to see if we can't clarify as neighbors how we can be better neighbors.
One other question, some of your earlier comments, I think you said you wanted to see an end to the sunset clause.
Yes, sir. The
you're talking about the end to the conditional use permit 2 year window?
The 2 year window in my particular instance, if we could remove that, I was asked in the lead up to this to sign that I agreed and would abide by the stipulations, or else so that I could be put on the docket. We found, I guess, that wasn't the correct process. And so I said I'd be happy to sign it if we took the sunset clause off and allowed me to be up until 2 by the planning's recommendations.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I do have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Ms. Longman mentioned trash. Did you want to speak to that as far as?
So I'm absolutely happy to address it. The issues I know that she dealt with specifically was that her dumpster was being used not only by the outlaw biker gang that was there, but also the construction from the new dance studio. Part of our procedures, security procedures at the end of the night, is to walk our lot, pick up trash. Daily on my walk from my car into my offices, I pick up any trash, not only in that lot, but in the adjacent lots, on the street, you name it. I wash my hands daily when I walk through the door of my place, because I'm literally handling any transient traffic's trash. And so when I first started to notice there was additional trash popping up in the parking lot, even after we had cleaned it, we realized that the young ladies sometimes would often, in their breaks, be leaving cups, whatever. And so I immediately reached out to Dee, who's the instructor that runs the studio, and the young ladies, and just talked to them about, they put a trash can out there now where trash goes. And that's one of the things I always try to do, is rather than be angry, there's been a couple of times where I came as we were leasing that lot and the dance studio had filled up the lot with cars in a way that made it unnavigable. Rather than get angry, I just went and would talk to them, just so that we could maintain a positive relationship, not only with Mrs. Longman and her as our leasing agent, but also, just so we could always cooperate and communicate on the block. Because I also felt like it was very important that those young people see that sometimes, even when they step over a boundary, that someone was willing to listen and speak with them rather than just get angry or tell them they can't do something. Because I know, learning and growing up, when someone told me how to navigate something rather than that they couldn't navigate something, it meant the world. So thank you.
Thank you.
One question. Yep. Relative to the sunset clause, I know you had your prior CUP expire. I'm struggling to consider that as a good reason for removing the sunset clause going forward. Can you elaborate a little bit on what extenuating circumstances you might have that would cause us to want to consider?
So, to be very honest with you, I should have paid a lot better attention to when that conditional use was first approved. I will point to the fact that in discussions that are now being had in these work sessions, and specifically things that other council folks have talked about and Mr. Melita has outlined, that there would be an inspection at the beginning of a business now that would denote the 2 years if they did implement that 2-year clause across the boards. And if that had happened with me, I probably would have been better in tune, but because I got my conditional use permit, then was closed because of COVID, and then delayed through my building process, it just crept up on me. And in Mrs. Pollock's email to me, she said the same thing. She emailed me 5 days after the expiration, and she said, oh, we should be doing a way better job of keeping on top of this, but did you guys realize this expired? We said, oh, holy cow, no, and immediately began the process again as soon as we were notified. But absolutely, I don't disagree with you. I should have absolutely paid a better attention to that date. And if that in the end is the causation for me to have to deal with it again, I guarantee you I'll be on top of it better next time.
Anything else while Mr. Burnell is at the podium? Great, thanks.
Thank you all so much.
So the opponents also have a 5-minute rebuttal period. Mrs. Longman is the only opponent. Is there anything else that you'd like to add?
I'd just like to make it clear that the time the parking lot was being used without our permission was during the time that it wasn't being leased by their organization. So prior to the lease being generated, the parking lot was being used without permission. And since the parking lot has now been locked up for the last 2 months after the lease expired, there have been people using the parking lot. Now, they may not be associated with Mr. Burnell, but I'm just letting the commission know that that is, in fact, what's going on. The parking lot is being used without our permission, even though it is actually locked up. I'm not saying he's generated that use. I'm saying that that's what's going on.
Okay. Thank you for the clarification. Commissioners, any comments or questions of the applicant or staff? We do have the issues of the hours and the sunset that the applicant would like changed, and so we need to decide whether or not we want to recommend that or vote on the recommendation from staff.
Just a question, is the 2-year sunset, is that for this type of request for CUP, or is that all for all?
It's the initial conditional use permit, and then after the business demonstrates that it's a good operator for 2 years and they go back through the process, then the presumption is that you would not have the 2-year sunset again. Okay. It would be a one-time thing. Is that accurate? Thank you.
Well, it sounds like to me they've demonstrated they've been a good neighbor, even handling a lot of adversity just from the beginning with a level of grace I aspire to. So, and, you know, I'm thinking about, obviously, the issue, the greater issue around violence, and thinking about when our young people and our creatives and our culture ambassadors have somewhere to go, they're in a safe place, as opposed to being on the fringe. And I'm in favor of letting them stay open until 2 a.m. or approving that for the CUP.
Thanks for mentioning that. Any discussion on that item?
Need a motion?
If anybody has anything to say on the subject, I'd like to, that talked about before the motion, and then we'll have the opportunity for discussion. All right, I guess, would we need a motion to consider that?
I think it's appropriate that if you'd like the staff recommendation to be revised, that the commission make that recommendation, so by motion, but I'm inviting you to explore the other issue of the hours of operation, the midnight versus the 2 o'clock that was requested, so that if there is a motion, you could do it all at once as to what it is you'd like Susan to read for the roll call vote.
Okay, so if someone would like to make a motion regarding the hours and the sunset, we'd entertain the motion, then it'd be an opportunity to discuss it, and then we would vote on either the recommendation or the approved motion.
Okay.
I'll make the recommendation that we allow the business to operate till 2 a.m. and we, based on their good stewardship of business for the last 2 years, that we also take away the requirement for the 2 year expiration.
Anyone want to second that?
I second it.
This would be the opportunity for discussion. Anyone want to add anything to that?
I just want to say, or I guess make sure I'm correct in that, you know, if something does happen, you're still able to pull a conditional use permit. Sunset or no sunset, if they violate the permit, we can pull the permit.
Right. The terms of this conditional use permit are the same as all the others that the council approves, which is that it can be revoked for the violation of any one of the conditions.
Right.
Right.
Sure, I was right about that.
Yes, so thank you for saying that out loud.
Thank you.
It's an important
You're
point.
You're quite welcome.
So, Susan, do you call the vote on the motion to change the recommendation?
I can do that if you'd like.
I think so.
Okay. All right. So the motion that we're talking about now would be to amend condition E, which is the hours of operation, and amending it from a closing hour from 12 o'clock midnight till 2 o'clock a.m., and then to eliminate condition I think it's DD, which would require that the conditional use permit expire in 24 months. So eliminating that condition. Mr. Fraley?
I want to thank Ms. Burnell for all the work that he's done in our community. And while I've got some trepidation about that particular motion, I think it's important that we try to give those in our community who go the extra mile to try to make things better an opportunity to prove themselves. Not that you haven't already, sir, but I think that we got a few ups and uh-ohs that came in here that we weren't expecting. So my trepidation is up, but I'm willing to give you a chance because of all the work that you've done in the past. I trust you'll continue to do that, and those that are associated with you will do likewise. I'm voting yes in support of this particular modified amendment, I'll call.
Shelton?
I just wanted to thank everyone who came out today. I know it probably doesn't seem like that when we've been somewhere 2.5 or 3 hours, but it really, we really do listen to you all. It really does make a difference when you write us a letter, when you send us an email, when you show up. And so I want to applaud all of you. Please continue to show up, whether you win the day or not win the day. It's really important to make it work, and I vote aye. Mr. Bateman?
I vote aye.
Mr. McGee?
Given some of the issues that our city's faced recently, I believe that restaurants and nightclubs with extended hours deserve a bit more scrutiny. With that being said, I appreciate your transparency and being here, Mr. Burnell. And I actually came into this discussion quite concerned about the noise concerns that we talked about earlier. But without a single stakeholder here expressing that concern, whether it be a resident, a business, or Civic League, I'm struggling to find that concern compelling. And so with that, I vote yes and wish you a lot of luck.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. And then now you would call the vote on the new motion.
So the motion is to approve the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the draft ordinance with the revised conditions pertaining to the closing hours and the elimination of the 24-hour expiration.
24-month expiration.
24 months, excuse me.
24 hours.
Mr. Fraley?
Aye. I've already said all I need to say. Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. And again, thanks to everyone who came down today.
Thank you all so much.
All right, so we're moving on to new business.
So, and I'll just read. To initiate an amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance to modify URO Upland Resilience Overlay to correct terminology and modify the development right extinguishment process.
Recognize I'm standing between everyone here and getting out of those chairs, so I'll try and be quick. The first item here is an initiation for a cleanup of the Upland Resilience Overlay. There's a provision where the text doesn't make sense when we're trying to get it. We've got some stakeholders who are trying to actually use this provision in code, and so they gave us a redlined list of changes they thought we needed to make. So the intent would be to visit this on your December agenda as amendments to clean up this ordinance.
Thank you.
Jeremy, the use of the term extinguishment period. Help me with that, please.
Well, you asked. So the proposal, the section of code here allows someone who is developing a piece of property on high ground, the upland, to get points towards their development out of the resilience quotient in exchange for extinguishing a development right on a property in the low ground, the coastal resilience overlay. So putting a conservation easement, for lack of a better term, as I'm told, putting a conservation easement on a piece of property that is undeveloped and saying, I will never, ever develop this ever again. So it really is extinguishing a development right.
You're right, I asked, didn't I?
You did ask.
Thank you for that, Jeremy.
Thank you. Anyone else have questions on this proposed text amendment? Susan?
The motion is to initiate the amendment. Mr. Fraley?
Aye.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
And then the next one is to initiate amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance to modify the eligibility requirements for an alternative signage conditional use.
So just to explain this briefly, the code currently allows, the code has sign requirements. The code currently allows for those sign requirements to be amended through a conditional use permit where, in certain circumstances, so large campus type settings, medical centers, large shopping centers, educational institutions. The code would allow essentially any amendment to the code, larger signs, more signs, digital signs, things like that. It's fairly open-ended, but it's open-ended to that it requires a conditional use permit. We got a request. This amendment, this initiation came to us, request came to us from a property owner that is looking to install a digital sign and what we would call a flashing sign, a digital sign that changes on a smaller piece of property than we would consider to be one of these locations. The specific request from this applicant would be a flashing sign that would change, and that would be the specific request. So we have approved, through conditional use permits, the city has approved a few of those around town. You'll know them by the giant billboards on the side, you know, the giant video boards on the side of certain buildings. That would be something that would be enabled with this amendment. I will say staff is not comfortable that this is something that we would support. Were this to be initiated and were we to take the time, I'm not sure that staff's comfortable making the effort to do this because that we would ever support this. There is a lot of safety concerns that come with sign regulations. Signs are distracting, particularly to drivers. So we are very cautious about opening up opportunities for additional signage in more places. And the concern here would be right now we have a very small box within which you can make this request. How many more requests will we be getting if we make that box a lot bigger? So it's unusual for us to bring an initiation to you and say we're not sure we support bringing it forward, but that's kind of where we are with this one. And I'd be happy to answer any questions on any specifics that you like.
Any questions about that?
Jeremy, so someone has asked us to consider allowing them to put a sign on some property they own?
That's correct.
All right, is this a 40-story building or a one-story ranch?
This is a one-story church.
Oh, the church in a residential community?
In general.
And the church wants a flashing, digital, changing sign.
In this case, that is what they're looking for, yes.
But there's not even a path for them to apply for a conditional use permit.
Correct. There's no path for them at this point to get that. They cannot ask for a variance from the Board of Zoning Appeals. They cannot get a conditional use permit from City Council. Right now, there is no path. This would be their path. They asked us to ask you whether you would consider giving them the path to come and ask you for their specific sign.
Any other
questions?
Yes.
So are billboards that change off the interstate or off main strips, are those covered?
They're covered by an entirely separate section of code, outdoor advertising signs. And this would not, I don't foresee that this, that these amendments would affect that at all. These amendments, I think, would, you know, there's an avenue to have to vary the sign requirements, and this would be, on individual property, this would be it.
So what, can you say it again for me, just what is it we're giving the option for someone to come to us?
So what we're asking you today is whether you want to assign staff to move forward with this amendment, to bring this amendment back to you for your full consideration. The amendment being giving properties, more properties permission to ask for the alternative signage, CUP.
So assuming, Mr. Chairman, excuse me, and Scott, I assume you're done.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So assuming you do this study, the prospects are that other properties of that type of operation would want to consider these signs as well?
I think that's our concern, is that right now we have a very small box. You have to be a large campus-like facility. So Janoff has this type of use. You know, Eastern Virginia Medical Center has this type of, you know, they may be under not CUPs under the old code, but they're essentially, they have this permission to have unusual signs. We don't know how tightly we would write this box. Maybe we would say it's just for institutional users. Maybe we would say it's for any commercial user can ask for this. I don't know how far we would want to go with that. That would be part of what we would have to do. But I think our concern is whatever we're doing, we're opening up a box that you know, we've committed as a city to Vision Zero to reducing traffic fatalities. We don't think these signs have a role. Any more signage has a role in reducing traffic incidents. In fact, the opposite would happen. We think that if you add more opportunity for signage, you just create more distractions and more opportunities for bad situations to happen.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Any other comments about the proposed zoning text amendment?
Just a quick question. So we're voting on whether or not to initiate the amendment, but if we did initiate the amendment, we would still need to vote to approve the amendment. Is that right?
That's correct. So what we're asking you today is essentially telling me that we can go forward with, that my staff can go forward with drafting this amendment. That doesn't mean that the commission at all would support approving the amendment, or that the commission would approve any specific, right, you know, CUP applications based on that amendment.
Okay, thank you.
And just to be clear, Jeremy, so a no vote here would mean that staff would not spend any more time on this and would go focus on other things.
That's correct.
Okay.
Okay, I think everyone's clear based on comments and questions. So, Susan, let's call the vote.
The motion would be to initiate the amendment. Mr. Fraley?
I see this as the first crack in Pandora's box. I vote no.
Ms. Shelton?
No.
Mr. Bateman?
I vote no, too.
Mr. McGee?
No.
Ms. Sutterth?
I feel like the people asked for this, and so I'm going to vote yes, but I feel like it's important to at least acknowledge that folks did ask. We still have other decisions to make down the road, so I vote yes.
And Mr. Murphy?
I'm tempted to initiate a text amendment that makes it more restrictive, because I don't think these signs ever work, no matter the scale or size. I vote no. And I'll keep that text amendment in my pocket for now. We're done with new business there. Comments from the commissioners. Paula Shea, our acting director, or not acting director, I'm sorry, assistant director.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, and I think Kathy, Commissioner Shelton, did a great job of this going in her recent comments here today. But we need to make a special point of making sure that we thank the citizens that come down here and give us comment. It's critically important. Whether they win the day or not, their input is vital. And since we are being broadcast, hopefully people will see and the word will get out. We are indeed appreciative of citizens who come down, take up their time, whether it's free time or work time or whatever the case may be. You're here at an awkward time during the week, during the day, and we appreciate the feedback you're giving us, whether you're for an application or against it. It helped give us a mighty fodder, if you will, and to make a reasonable recommendation to City Council. So thank you to all the citizens who take the time to give us a written comment or come down to give us verbal comments. We appreciate it.
Amen to that.
Are you going to make a motion to have a nighttime meeting every other month?
I can do that since I won't be here, right?
Oh, no.
Oh, wow. That's dangerous.
I'll keep that one in my back pocket.
Any other comments from the commissioners? Assistant Director Shea, anything you have to add?
Nothing. Thank you.
Mr. Melita?
Yes, sir.
This meeting's adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.